What are you doing?
I have no idea what he was doing. I was trying to figure it out.
Yeah, he was humming the song.
You know how it goes. Oh, and I forgot to put the Greg video. I did make it, though. I did make it. I just forgot to put it there. Sorry, Greg. It's a running joke at this point, right?
And everybody, we're going to have Matt Damon on tonight.
Matt Damon.
All right, guys. It's been a good show.
Welcome, Level Uppers, to the Level Up Show, episode 102. This is a gaming-dedicated talk show on every Sunday at 10 p.m. Eastern Time. I am one of your co-hosts, Andrew Midori. I am joined by the classy douchebag, Mike McLaughlin. We also got the beast from the east, Dean Marchese.
It's just me.
And on the line, we got Gregory Verga, a.k.a. GVZ.
Paging Mr. GVZ. Paging Mr. GVZ.
Nope.
Yo, 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 it's your boy!
All the note.
I'm okay with it, I think.
Really?
I'm okay with it. I'm okay with anything Greg does, to be honest.
I was gonna say, I feel like there's nothing that he's done so far. You're like, no.
And that's how you do it, guys. Claire Lore Burrito, I think is how you said it. He followed us on the right channel. Or she. I'm not sure. Claire probably implies it's a she. So thank you so much, Claire, for the follow. Keep those coming, guys. If you're watching at twitch.tv/TheLevelUpShow, hit that follow button in the corner, of course, and we will shout you out. We're also on Twitter at The Level Up Network, level spelled LVL. Tweet at us with hashtag on the spot or hashtag IODP because we got our PlayStation talk show coming up this Wednesday. So we're going to need four fan-submitted PlayStation questions. We also have youtube.com/TheLevelUpShow for archive stuff that we do, and you also have Dean and Greg's exclusive YouTube show called Power Up. It's all about comic book superhero nerdiness.
Superheroes.
Hey, do you guys cover the Archie comic?
Nope.
I saw you cover Jessica Jones, the whole series, and you also did the Civil War reactions.
Yeah, it's been kind of nice because like our topics of the weeks have been like hand delivered for the last like 3 weeks. I'm like, I'll take it.
And Deadpool hopefully will be soon. It was supposed to be this week.
Yeah, I thought, wasn't it supposed to be Thursday?
Greg, what happened there?
Me?
I didn't. Yeah, what happened with Deadpool? Wasn't that supposed to be on like Thursday?
I tried researching it because it was supposed to release on Thursday. It was supposed to release at 7:30 p.m. Pacific time, and that didn't end up happening. There's no reason why it didn't release so far that I've been able to discover, but yeah, it just didn't happen. There was another trailer that recently
what happened
did that, though.
Wasn't that supposed to be on, like,
release,
Thursday?
And then they were just,
what the hell is that?
Gregory!
Yes. Because it was supposed to release on Thursday.
Hold on, I probably have... I found it. It's okay.
It's you. Never mind.
Was it a... did they say, like, this is happening? This is gonna release?
Yeah. They released an official statement. I actually read it through Superhero Hype, Dino, the website you use all the time for our power-up info. And then IGN had tweeted something about it. And then I went back on IGN's Twitter feed, and they deleted the tweet. So something went wrong. Something happened. I don't know. But hopefully we get something soon from them. They were supposed to be the thing Ryan Reynolds was talking about, dropping the trailer, because they were doing a panel or something in Brazil, Comic-Con Brazil or something. We never got a trailer from them.
Comic-Con Brazil.
Yeah, sure, why not?
Okay, Comic-Con's everywhere now. That's cool. No. So last but not least, we have our levelupnetwork.com/donate. If you want to support our network, you got the levelupshirt.spreadshirt.com for level-up themed hoodies, muscle shirts, and more. And lastly, most importantly, actually, you got patreon.com/levelupnetwork, where you can donate just $1 per month and get perks like early access to Power Up. Typically goes up on Saturdays around 10.
Yeah, I was on time this week.
Yeah, but if you are a Patreon supporter, you get it much earlier in the week, sometimes 4 or 5 days early.
So, Monday night if I can, Tuesdays for sure.
Yeah, so we try to give back in those ways, and we have plans for the future, of course. We'll try and improve the Patreon as things move on. All right, so how are you guys doing this week? What's going on?
Good. Busy.
Yeah.
This week was real busy.
But it's over, right?
It's kind over of... now, yeah. Thank God. I had finals. I had a 9-page research paper. I was doing all the Christmas lights outside, working, finishing school finals. It was just too much.
Yeah.
I played barely any video games.
I didn't play one thing this week, so you're okay. No. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, like I saw you playing the Avengers or whatever, the Marvel.
Yeah, because I woke up this morning with my brain, like, laser-focused on my backlog, and I was like, I am going to start finishing games, and so I'm just trying to chip away, like, at things that I have, like, lingering, like, games that I got a good ways through, like the Marvel game, Ori, I'm going to finish,
Thank God.
I need to get around that too.
Yeah, I want to finish like those little things before I start taking on anything big, like finishing Kingdom Hearts, like The Witcher or something. You know?
Right.
Yeah.
I feel like The Witcher is just something that's never
going to happen. I've decided. You know what? Right. I was back and forth, and I was like, I'll get to it eventually, and then I was like looking at my backlog because I love lists and I write everything down, and I was like,
I'm gonna get you.
I'm taking you down, son of a bitch.
Yeah, that's an intimidating opponent right there.
Right.
Yeah, I agree with that. What's going on with you, Mike?
Actually, I have quite a few things. I saw the Peanuts movie.
Oh, I heard it was good. Nice.
It was pretty good. It was. You know what's funny is, have you guys watched
the Peanuts movie?
The Penis movie, Greg. Okay. Penis.
That's what I.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Have you guys watched any Peanuts stuff?
Yeah, I mean, I've watched all the recently. Classic holiday stuff.
And
you know.
It's very dry, very dull, and everything like that. And they've tried to pep it up a decent amount, which was nice. It's going to be lost in this generation.
Okay.
For a lot of things, but at the same time, there's going to be enough people that like it that they're going to have another one.
I mean, yeah, it did solid as far as the reviews go. I don't know how it did critically, but or I mean, commercially. But.
I liked it. I don't think it did great commercially, but and then I saw a Good Dinosaur last week.
Oh, see, this is very mixed. I'm here. Yeah. A guy at work saw it. He thought it was just okay, and a few other people thought it was great. So
it's the most generic Pixar movie I've ever seen.
Okay, even more than Cars.
No, you know what's funny is that every single one of Pixar's movies. Actually, no, Cars was a little. Oh, yeah, it was a little generic, I guess.
Cars is my least favorite of all the Pixar movies.
It's definitely not my least favorite. It's probably right in the middle. Okay. Just because it's a very basic tale, but what's cool about it, and a lot of people don't realize, it's a Western, almost in a way, where it's set almost like in a down south farmland back in like the 1800s.
Okay.
The dinosaurs are actually the main characters, are the ones that can talk. The humans can't.
Yeah.
And
twist.
The human and the dinosaur... but like the dinosaurs have their own farm, they live on their own. It's like they meet up with like wrestlers at some point with a herd of animals. So it's cool. It's charming. Danny loved it. She cried. This is the third movie now that she's cried at. And
Pixar wise or just in general?
In general.
Okay.
Yeah, she's not a big crier for movies.
Yeah, I was gonna say that's not a lot of crying.
No.
For a little girl.
No, yeah. She does. She holds herself up pretty well, like to where she lets herself go and actually cry. Like she'll
has she
up.
Seen The Lion King?
Yeah.
Did she cry?
She teared up pretty damn well.
Okay.
But she saw it at such a young age that it didn't really hit her.
Show her Grave of the Fireflies.
I don't know if I want to ever do that.
She will. I'll tell you right now, I sobbed at that movie. It's animated. It's animated, but I sobbed at that movie. It's brutal.
Did she watch Iron Giant?
No, I haven't.
That got me too.
I feel like that might get her. Yeah. Now that she's at the age where I think it's like certain things that are hitting her more. But she sobbed at this. She was like in my shoulder crying at it. But no, I liked it. And then I think that was kind of it. I didn't do anything else really.
Yeah, I'm trying to think. I'm continuing with Jessica Jones.
Yeah,
it's getting better. I'm on episode 9 now. Ooh. We're at the spoiler alert. We're at the like the more like Kilgrave stuff where she's living with him.
That's
and
kind
like
of the turning point.
Yeah.
God damn it.
Huh? What?
I'm not there yet.
You're not there yet. I won't say anything more than that. Then I won't say anything more than that. But it definitely is interesting. The dynamic has changed a little bit, and her plan for Kilgrave has changed now, of course. But I don't want to say what. But yeah, it's interesting. I like the twist there that happened, and. It's getting better as it goes along. I do agree with you guys. All of you guys have said it gets better. It definitely is. Fargo, man. Holy shit, guys. If you guys aren't watching Fargo, that show is amazing.
Yeah?
It is
I have
just,
to watch that.
It's up there with Leftovers, Greg.
No.
Yes. It's that good.
True.
Like, this freaking year for TV, Leftovers Season 2 and Fargo Season 2 have been some of the best TV I've ever watched. Like, it is so damn good.
Nice.
I really recommend it, Greg. Watch season 1 and season 2 if you haven't watched.
I'm gonna
season
have to
one
watch yet. Both. Yeah, I have to watch both.
Okay, yeah, because they're both good, very good. Games wise, as I said, I haven't had time at all with the whole floors. We put in the floors upstairs, decorating for Christmas.
Did you guys put them in yourself?
No, we had somebody come out. That would have taken me freaking months.
Well, that's what I was asking. I was like, that was really quick.
Yeah, no, there's no way I could have done that myself. We had guys come out to do it. Ghost Scheme says, who is Jessica Jones, and is Fargo like the movie? Jessica Jones is a Marvel character, but I don't know about her comic, really. Is it called Alias?
It was called Alias.
Yes.
They didn't name it that so you didn't get confused with the TV
It's
show.
A part of the 6 parts Netflix deal. There's going to be, I think, 6, right? Netflix Marvel
5?
TV shows?
5?
And then it's going to...
there's
going to
be 5 altogether. It's Jessica Jones, Daredevil's already happened, Luke Cage, Iron Fist, and what's the last one? Is it Miss Marvel? No, it's not Miss Marvel.
They're doing a Moon Knight one.
Moon Knight, that's who it was.
Yeah.
Thank you.
The Moon Knights.
The Moon Knights.
The Moon Knights.
It's going to be an interesting... Yes, I know what that is.
Okay, I was wondering if you know what also. That was.
But I don't... I'm not acknowledging it because it wasn't Adam Sandler reference.
Okay, it'll come later. I'll make sure I get an Adam Sandler reference somewhere. But yeah, that's about it for me. I haven't had time to play games. But Monday, tomorrow, actually, Kristen has something to go to. So I think I might do a little bit of Life is Strange before your stream, Greg. So
that's a beautiful thing to my
It is a beautiful thing. You tried Gauntlet.
I said that sentence out of order.
How was Gauntlet?
It hasn't aged greatly.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like visually and anything like that, control wise, it's fine.
Mm-hmm.
But just there's other games that offer better content.
It's free though, right?
So. It's free, so it's not a terrible thing.
Yeah. What was else was free this month? Oh, King's Quest. And I still haven't gotten that yet. I'll get around to that one too. I need to at least put it into my library because that's something I would like to play someday. Yeah. I wanted to say, I know, like, Strife Girl probably wants me to talk. I'm going to talk about the Final Fantasy VII debacle later on in the show. I know that it's kind of like a separate news story from PSX, but I'm going to wait until we get to the Final Fantasy VII thing. Did you hear about it?
No.
Really potentially upset at the news that just came out about Final Fantasy VII.
Oh, yeah, I did.
Oh, sure. I'm ready to flip shit. We're going to have a little message about joysticks later on in this show, so get ready for that. All right, let's get into our official non-gaming portion of the show. It's called The Level Up Show Has No Game. It is 3 non-gaming topics, 2 minutes each. Are we ready, guys?
Born ready.
Born ready? Play? All right, let's do it. First up... I'm happy about this news. Black Panther may have found its director, and it is a director that we have all seen the movie, most recent movie of. It's called Creed, and it's freaking awesome.
I heard it's great, though.
Are you awesome. The only one that's seen it?
Yeah, I haven't gotten
a chance.
Oh, you did.
No, I haven't gotten a chance to. Because I haven't seen Spectre. I haven't gotten to a movie.
I don't have any plans to see Spectre.
I know you're a James Bond. See Creed first, dude. Creed is so fucking good.
I heard that, though. I know that. You.
It was damn good.
If you see Spectre before you see Creed... Man,
that's likely going to happen.
But the guy's name is Ryan Coogler, and he is, I think, first in line to direct Black Panther.
That's the best news.
Yeah, that's awesome.
It's awesome.
He's a black guy, Ryan Coogler, and he started off with Fruitvale Station, which is also excellent, also stars Michael B. Jordan. Mm-hmm. He moved on to Creed. So I like that they're kind of taking an African-American director that already has a really good track record. 2 movies in a row, all both above 90% on Rotten Tomatoes, both written by Ryan Coogler. So he's a really promising new director, and it's great that he's black, and he gets to direct this you know, one of the first big-time black superheroes in Marvel's camp, at least. Blade, I think, would be the other one, right?
Yeah, probably.
It's funny, as I was saying, Fat Man on Batman, they were talking about how Black Panther was featured on the cover of Entertainment Weekly with Cap and Danny Jr. and everything like that, but he was like in the background, but he was like the star focal point. It's like, meet the new, you know, thing. But they made fun of him. It's like, this cat has claws that Desperate Housewives would be jealous of or something like that. And it's just like, why would you have feet?
What are his claws made out of again?
Vibranium.
Vibranium.
Cap's shield's made out of.
Oh, okay.
That's where that metal comes from. He's like the guy. He has all of it.
Yeah, he's a king. He is more powerful, stronger, and actually better than Iron Man. He's pretty much the most powerful.
No, Captain America.
I don't know, dude.
He's stronger and faster than Captain America, hands down.
No, Black Panther is or Cap is.
Yeah, that's like, shut your mouth. Shut your damn mouth. It's over. Next up, I decided. We do Star Wars news every week, so I'm just gonna go through everything that happened Star Wars wise this week. 136 minutes long.
First time.
Yeah, I like that.
I'm good with this.
It is right on track with pretty much all the other ones, especially the original trilogy. Those were all around 135. The prequel trilogy was a little bit longer.
It was like almost 2.5.
Overstayed its welcome, typically. Yes. So this is good news. 136 minutes. Second, it will have cantina music.
Yeah.
Two. Woo! This is the good hand.
That's good stuff. Chris and I have something to dance to. Carrie Fisher felt pressured to lose weight.
Yay!
No, that's not good.
Is that good or bad?
Pressure. I don't think that's
put her back in slave land. Or slave.
I mean, it's good for her that she lost weight.
Right. No, and
it's bad that she felt pressured, but at the same time, it's like Mark Hamill, Carrie Fisher. I think you should probably thank them. You guys both look great right now, and you're a lot healthier. So, good for you guys. Fourth, Harrison Ford saw the whole movie. He said it is quote wonderful.
Right, and that's basically how he is not excited for any of it.
Yeah, he was. It was such a I don't know what he was on or what he was being interviewed for. He's like, I've seen it. It was wonderful. It has high production values.
Yeah,
that's all he said. Yeah. Thanks, Harrison Ford.
He doesn't care. Dude, yeah. He was a janitor. No, he just came in and he's like, all right, better money. Sounds yeah. Great. Like,
there was other things too. I can't remember. Oh, the other one was that Carrie Fisher said she thinks it's really dumb and annoying
yep.
that everybody gets pissed off over the Leia slave outfit.
Like she was the one that kind of started it, unfortunately.
Yeah.
But like she was like, this is not what I wanted.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's just I thought it was a. I don't like that they want to sexualize everybody.
Yeah.
But they didn't want you to ban an iconic. Yeah, shut up. Stop talking.
Shut your mouth.
Like you're dumb.
Yeah, and I think that was about it really for the Star Wars news this week. I figured I would just go through it as quickly as possible. We're all still pretty excited. So how,
yeah. Did you see the picture I posted in Level Up? The movie's about a black guy and a white girl. And a man in a hood with a crossed.
I must not have seen this. I must have. Oh, never mind. That went quick. It felt like it did.
We had a vamp at the end.
And last but not least, let's just watch this.
Watch.
Spoiler alert for Game of Thrones. Earmuffs.
And we remember.
And eyes. Blindfold.
The past is already written. The ink is dry.
I told you. Spoiler.
They have no idea what's going to happen.
Boom, bitch.
Was it though? Was that from last season? Or
yeah,
was
that was from the last season, yeah.
Okay,
that was
at the end of last season. So it wasn't like here is.
What's interesting is yeah. Once again we're seeing such a focus on Jon Snow
right.
In the poster and now the teaser, and it's like this is weird because he supposedly died at the end of last season. Why are we so focused on Jon Snow
yeah.
In the teaser, the poster? Do we have any theories?
Because he still knows nothing.
Because we know as much as Jon Snow does.
You know nothing, Jon Snow. I don't know. I what was your theory you came up with this week?
Well,
I've heard this before.
I'm still on the fence, but possibly Bran could be used to actually take control of Jon Snow's body.
You saw him at the end there. He kind of did his warg eyes.
Right. They focused a lot on Bran, and I know it's because we didn't see him at all last season.
Mm-hmm.
Possibly. I actually don't feel that that's as much. It was just like a thought that came to my head. I was like, oh my god, that would be crazy. But I feel like he's actually going to have a lot more to do with taking control of the dragons as they come in.
You think he'll take control of the dragons?
Yes, I think he'll take control of the dragons, and that's what will bring Daenerys over here, or unite her with Jon Snow. I still think the Red Priestess going back has...
That's what I was going to say. I feel like
that's from day one, immediately as she went back, when I was watching the show, I was like, she's here for a reason.
Greg, are you caught up on Game of Thrones?
I am.
Yeah, what's your theory? What's your theory on Jon Snow? Do you think he's coming back, and how, if so, would he come back?
All I'm going to say is we didn't see him die.
Not necessarily, no.
That's really all my theory. There's so much going on right now. I don't think he's dead. I think everyone can agree on that. He's too big of a character, I think. Especially
he just feels unfinished, right?
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, there's still so much story to his character. I feel like they set him up for so much, and to leave all of his questions unanswered like that, I just don't think it's possible.
Two other things that I was hoping that they would cover.
Better be quick, man.
Baratheon.
Okay.
And I want to see more of Spider.
Okay. Just getting out there. In time, too.
Yeah, you're welcome.
I told you. I was like, 5 seconds, dude. Get it done.
Do me a favor.
Yeah.
Shut off the video to our Gmail call. I want to see if that'll help something for the stream. There's a little bit of crackling going on with the mics.
Okay. We might be a little too loud, potentially.
Maybe that's a problem, I guess. There's a little bit of crackling. Sorry, that's why I was so quiet that whole time. I was trying to figure out what the crackling was. And I was trying
all right,
to
hold on 1 sec. Let me go to. So our video is showing. Okay.
Yeah. So maybe if you shut that off, I don't know if that'll help stuff, but.
A little bit of crap.
Everyone. I'm not frozen. I'm here. I was just trying to figure out. And then Brad pointed out, and somebody else pointed it out too. So it wasn't just my computer that was hearing the crackling audio. And Tobes just said, yeah, the audio is skipping occasionally or something.
That's not good. I guess. This is a new setup that we're trying here. We're trying out the dual Yeti mics.
The only time it's crackling for me is when all three or multiple of us is talking, like are talking at the same time. Otherwise, when it's just solo performances, everyone's fine. So as long as we're not,
it's probably
as long as we're not all talking at the same time.
Yeah, so as long as we don't break out into a duet or three part
no more No more Queen.
Yeah, one day, Queen again.
Could you make sure the just the cable is pushed in there tight on the bottom there?
Shove it in.
Tighten up.
Also, if there is any way to turn down my volume.
No, don't tilt it forward. Just keep it up, yeah.
Okay.
But no, just because if you tilt it down, that directs it more towards like the fans and stuff like that, so it might pick up the fans if we do that. Let me know if that's any better, Greg. I don't know.
I'm watching. I have the stream going in the background, too. Right now, it's fine. It's been crystal clear. It's just when we were all talking at the same time, it was cracking a little bit and popping. So.
Okay.
Rammer Man says, audio is so bad, I can hear Greg.
Guys in the chat, let us know if that helped at all. When I was doing the PlayStation Experience reaction, everything sounded perfect.
Oh, yeah, I forgot you did that.
Yeah, I just watched the whole thing. It was, we'll talk about that later.
God.
It was okay.
I saw the very beginning and then the last, like, 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Right, I read, like, the stuff and then I was like, all right, so this conference was great. Or pretty decent.
Yeah, right, if you watch certain portions.
And
yeah.
I went back, I was like, oh, never mind, I watched the whole conference before.
All right, let's go to a quick commercial break and then we'll get into the level update, guys. We'll be back in 60 seconds.
Yeah.
Let's see what the chat says here. Good for now, says Brad. That's good.
Yeah, now it sounds fine. Sorry, I didn't mean to like stop the show for a second. I just wanted it to be.
It's not overly annoying because it isn't constant. If it's not constant, then it's probably.
I didn't mean to mess everything up for you guys.
It was fine in the very beginning, and then it started up when we started Has No Game. Like, it was fine for the whole beginning, and then as soon as we started that segment, it just started.
It might be. The computer might be overwhelmed, is what it might be.
Maybe. I don't know.
And that's an issue that will be rectified hopefully soon once we're not dual streaming and having our computer overloaded by like 10 things going on at once.
Yeah. Are we still dual streaming?
We're still dual streaming until I know for sure that the Twitch app is available everywhere. And I still don't know for sure that it's even... Like, I don't know. I didn't see him say the other day, Brad, or anybody from the UK, Miss Mel, let us know if you have access to the Twitch app yet over there in Europe. Because last I checked, you guys didn't. And we're not going to go solo on the Twitch app until we know everybody can watch us.
Right.
55 people on the stream, though.
Nice. Thank you for joining us, guys. Really appreciate it. I'm getting an ad now. Why? It's because we're streaming from PC. You guys can't miss the ads anymore watching from PlayStation.
Okay, yeah, it sounds much better now.
Okay, good.
Yeah.
Welcome back, Level Uppers. This is the Level Up Show, episode 102. We're about to get into the Level Update, our discussion of the week's biggest gaming industry news. But first, thank you to a couple follows. We had, let's see here, 3 or 4 follows. Diplomatic 89. Make sure to follow us on the Level Up Show. Thank you to Tommy B the Ginger and Claire Ator. Claire Ator Burrito, if I'm not saying that right. I don't know. And Tats followed us on the network. Make sure to follow us on twitch.tv/TheLevelUpShow. We'd appreciate
thank
that.
You.
We got 55 people in the room. Thank you so much for joining us, everybody. Just hit that follow button if you can at the bottom of the screen. Let's get into the level update. I'm in everything this week, Greg, aren't you?
I'm in a very Mariah Carey Christmas mood, so.
Oh, that's terrible.
Uh-huh. First You're up, welcome. Final Fantasy XV can be played from start to finish.
Shut your mouth.
Quote, pre-beta version refers to the product of development on Final Fantasy XV that was put together in October this year. We have managed to achieve two things with this pre-beta. We have managed to get the game in a state where you can play the whole thing through from the opening to the ending. By doing this, all the dev staff are now able to get a shared impression of the overall game. In short, we can now say that we have done the groundwork for finishing all the different areas of content in the game, and the overall product itself is to a high standard, polishing up each individual element and fine-tuning the gameplay. There are mechanics and elements that are still undergoing testing and are not implemented in the release code yet, but making it possible for all the dev staff to grasp an overall image of the game is very important for the next stage of the development process. As a programmer, I am now in a situation where I can concentrate on the process of optimization and will be pulling out all the stops to get the appeal of the finished product across to people as much as possible. We have polished the first half of the game to final retail quality and have established the final feel of the gameplay. By doing this, we have been able to extrapolate how much work will be necessary in order to bring all aspects of the game, including the feel of the gameplay and the standard of the visuals, up to the final quality level we envision. At the same time, we have been able to check how actual players will approach playing the game and the pace of their play by inviting valuable players from outside the company in for focus testing. We have entered the final phase of production now, where the technology and people's feelings and intuition come together, and this is where the programmers can really show their stuff. You can expect great things from us. That is kind of crazy. I didn't know it was that far along. Half the game is polished to final retail quality, and it's playable from start to finish. That's great news.
What the hell were they just running with?
Chocobos.
No. They were running on chocobos. What were the bony, armor-piercing, stag-like things?
Those are... I think they look very similar to like an old-school Final Fantasy monster. I can't remember the exact name. It kind of is like a unicorn, but very emaciated-looking.
Bonus stags.
Bonus stags. Exactly. Thank you.
Thanks, Steve.
Yes, our Final Fantasy expert over here, Dean. Bonus stags. Was that bonus stags or boner stags?
You know.
Oh, I know.
You know.
Yeah, I'm also a Final Fantasy fan. Yeah, I know. But yeah, that's really exciting news. Yeah, cool. That probably means that they might be on track to really get this thing out in 2016, like they
said.
Holiday is my guess. We're going to find out the final release date on Final Fantasy 15 at their event in March. They've promised that for several months now. Mm-hmm. And maybe Final Fantasy 7's not that far behind that, according to the most recent news. So we'll talk about that later.
I had something said to me this evening, and I want to see how you react, because I really, spoilers for the chat out there, I actually don't know jack shit about Final Fantasy. Okay. Someone said to me, Final Fantasy 6 is one of the best games of all time. It's better than Final Fantasy 7.
Those are the two best Final Fantasy games.
True?
And yes, of the pre-7 stuff, 6 is 100% easily the best one of all. And it is right there with 7. I think my one grievance with 6, and this is one of the things people love about 6, is I think it actually has too many characters.
Okay.
I like a little bit more of a tighter focus on the characters, and 6, oh my god, I mean, I'm off here. I know there's over a dozen that eventually you can play as, and they all have a really great story, but since it's split up between so many of them, I feel like it has less of a focus than 7 does, and that's what I really appreciate about 7.
I just came in and just started telling you things, like I knew, like, because I talked to him it's a buddy of mine, it's one of Jen's older cousins, he's like in his 30s, but I actually knew him, he's a musician.
Yeah.
And I actually knew him before I knew he was cousins with Jen. I knew him before I knew Jen.
Sure.
And then it turned out, like, I went to their house for, like, a family thing, and I was like, I've been here before. And then he walked out, I was like, holy shit, you guys are related! So it was him, and we were talking about Final Fantasy, and, like, he's a man of very few words, and he was just like, saw that Final Fantasy VII footage, because he knows, like, I'm all into games and stuff, and I was like, oh, yeah, what you think? And he was like, Final Fantasy VI is one of the greatest games of all time.
There is a huge rivalry between 6 and 7, because 6 was pre-PlayStation back when Nintendo owned Final Fantasy, and then, that really caused a lot of, that was kind of like the Genesis versus, like, Nintendo, like, it's, what was that?
I was also told 9 is very good.
9 is my second favorite Final Fantasy game.
There's a lot of people that will argue to the death that 9 is better than 7.
I would say, for me, it's 7, 9, 6.
He was one of them. He said
nine. And I hear it a lot. Like, there's a lot of people...
Nine is almost tied with me for 7. And a lot of people don't agree with that, but I love 9.
The thing that holds it up more for you is the nostalgia factor, and it's something that really got you into that type of game.
If I played 9 first, it probably would have been my favorite.
Yeah, and that's the thing, is that if you look at it from a nostalgic view, 7 is better.
And then I asked him, if I want to get into it, which one should I play? Does it matter? He's like, no, they're all pretty much separate. Just play it. And I was like, okay, which one should I start with? He said, none of them. Play Chrono Trigger.
I might agree with that.
You should meet this guy, dude.
Chrono Trigger is...
Is his name Drew?
If we go down to it, Chrono Trigger, in my opinion, is better than Final Fantasy VI.
Whoa.
I think of the... Anything Greg but pre-PlayStation RPGs, Chrono Trigger is the greatest of all time. Mm-hmm. If you go
pre-PlayStation. Who's making bold statement?
All right.
That's just my opinion.
There's a lot of people that say that.
Yeah, Chrono Trigger is very, often referenced.
Speaking of,
as...
because I don't think we bring it up at all, I was watching Final Fantasy VII gameplay earlier today. I watched actually this guy stream for a while.
Yeah.
It cleaned up really fucking good. Like, I usually don't care about stuff like that, but they cleaned it up for the PC really good.
You're talking about the Steam port.
Yes.
Okay.
Which is, because to me, the last thing I saw of it was the PS3 version. That's the last time I saw it, which all it was is they just said, alright, we'll just emulated from the PS1, and it's just very edgy and scraggly, and it's very rough. And this is, everything is smooth. Barrett's face, you can actually see details, other than that he was just a black man. Like, I can actually see what
when you're
like
in the actual combat, where the character models become a little bit better, as opposed to the chibi look when you're just running on the overworld. They look pretty decent for PlayStation days. The Gravy Biscuit said, didn't I like Final Fantasy 4 as well? Anything besides 6 in the pre-PlayStation days, I played them, but I wasn't like, I don't know, I didn't get like sucked into them.
I really like 3. I'm actually a big fan.
Three was one that actually didn't come over to America originally.
No, I played on the DS.
See, this is the thing. It's weird. Three is what a lot of people consider six to be.
Yeah.
Yeah, because when six came to America, it was Final Fantasy III, and then finally they.
Sorry, guys. I didn't know this was gonna happen.
Fixed everything. Just Mike, start. I'm gonna go shut off the air because that's gonna bother me.
The game that Sony Santa Monica was teasing is Bound. The ballerina game that they had teased before was revealed this week. According to the developer, it's a not game, which is also a game.
That sounds dumb.
The fuck, man?
Have you heard anything about this?
No. Bound is a 3D platformer designed for people with a desire to concentrate on the narrative side of games and experience a mature story. All right.
Okay. I mean, that sounds really good.
You got my attention so far.
Can't wait to play.
On the other side of the spectrum, Bound is also being prepared for hardcore gamers looking to challenge. That's not true. Looking to challenge one of the big one big puzzle that can only be solved by a community of players working together. All right, that's kind of better. The modern art style is for those of you who are interested in suprematism. Oh my god!
Yeah, this is a kind of artsy.
Wait.
Kind of artsy.
Suprematism.
Yes.
Concertism, yes. Neoplasticism, and what Bauhaus has delivered.
Whoa!
The main character is a ballerina and is based on work by dancer Maria Udodo. God damn it.
I might just stop talking and Greg and I will talk about this, because this is clearly a game Greg and I would play.
The soundtrack will be a blend of ballet and electro. God.
Greg! am I right? This is the kind of game we play.
100% you're right with that. From what I saw of all the reveals at PSX, I just kind of watched all the trailers and everything. I didn't watch the whole conference just because I didn't have time to. But this is definitely one that I saw, and it's definitely on my radar for sure. I'm excited to see where it goes. Was there a release date or anything? No, right?
No, I don't think so. They're kind of just
yeah, it definitely looks enticing for sure. It looks like a different. I really like Drew and I both. I think I can speak for both of us when we say we like different games, especially ones that go and try to tell like a unique or totally different story from any other game that's been released before. So this is definitely on my radar. I'm excited for this. Sorry, Dean.
I mean,
and Mike.
I like different games. I just don't like dumb ones, dude. You know,
it has that artsy kind of thing that Journey had in a sense. I don't know. It looks like it's experimental. They're trying new things. I like that. I like
when
they go
like
for.
Flower?
You like flower? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I just wouldn't like this.
No, I'm 100%.
I don't think that
I'm
you
not
would
even
like this.
Play
no.
Around like I'm like,
no, you're
like,
you 100%. No. I can tell you right now, we're not gonna even talk.
What was the game? What was the game during? What was it? The VGAs or the PSX? Where I was like, this looks like a game everyone's gonna call charming.
Oh my god! Fucking. I can't remember.
Was it during PSX?
Yeah, it was during PSX.
Remember, was it the PSX or
it was 100% PSX?
Or the VGAs?
Yeah, it was PSX.
Can't remember the game
saying,
though.
You came into it late, and I was remember talking with Rick about it.
Dean, why don't you take the next story? This is kind of your style here.
Mass Effect.
Nope, wrong.
I got it.
The first word was mass, so Dean immediately went to Mass Effect.
That's all I can think about. It's a rumor. Mass production on Nintendo NX begins in quarter 2 of 2016.
That's a mass
which
effect.
I don't believe.
No?
No, and I'll tell you why, but let me read this story first, alright? DigiScience writes, Nintendo's new game console is scheduled to enter mass production at the end of the first quarter of 2016, and despite the fact that the Japan-based company is targeting to ship 20 million units in 2016, the device's upstream component suppliers expect shipments to only reach around 10 to 12 million units. Foxconn Electronics, Han High Precision Industry, reported... That reminds me of like the first time someone read... When you like first read S.H.I.E.L.D. in the movie, he's like, yeah, I get a new name for that. Reportedly has been chosen to manufacture the device, but the company declined to comment on its clients for orders. Or orders, excuse me. The new console is estimated to enter mass shipments in the second quarter. In addition to Foxconn, suppliers such as Foxconn Technology, Micronics, Pixart Imaging, Coxon Precise Industrial, Nishoku Technology, Delta Technology, Linxon Precision Industries, and Jantech will also supply components for the device. DigiTimes research expects Microsoft's Xbox One and Sony's PlayStation 4 to achieve shipments of 13 and 18 million units, respectively, in 2016. And if Nintendo's new console is able to ship 10 million units a year, the company will then be able to maintain its competitiveness in the markets.
I love that Dean and Mike got the two stories with all the hardest words to say. Because
I didn't plan that. It wasn't rigged or anything like that. No, first, it was a golem. that you thought was too, like, charming and not for you?
I'll look it up and I'll tell
yes,
you.
Yes, I think so.
The virtual reality one?
Yeah.
Because I was totally like, this looks great!
It was. No, it was the one with three letters to it.
Hob.
Hob. I think that was it.
Damn it, I thought that one looked good, too.
No, it wasn't Hob.
No, it wasn't. Okay,
it wasn't
so it was
Hob because
then.
I was watching Hob and I was like, that looks fun, actually. It reminded me of, Brothers.
Reminded me of Knack.
So, yes. All right, so it was Golem then.
I actually kind of like Knack, too.
Knack's awesome.
But it was something, it was like one of those things, and then just the way they were talking about it, everybody was like, oh, how about this just looks so charming, it's going to be really fun. I'm going to fucking hate this game.
Alright, well back to why you don't think Nintendo
because it's a
NX.
Weird time for them to launch it.
No, it's not that they're saying quarter two is when they're launching it, it's when they start mass production. They have to start production on these things much earlier than when it releases.
Yeah, I guess that's true, but...
They gotta make 10 million of these damn things.
You gotta remember, they have a big announcement scheduled for tomorrow.
Yeah,
and
I don't.
There's,
I don't
that's
know.
True. They do.
Did you? You didn't put it in there.
I didn't put it in here. But
okay, guys. For those of you that don't know, there's a big Nintendo Direct announcement teasing big news. Essentially,
you know it's not going to be this, right?
So here's my thought
process.
It's
going to be like the fucking the duck from Duck Hunt.
It's
going to
be dressed as like
the duck from Duck Hunt. How does that work?
Oh my god! Can you imagine? That would be the greatest
it's
thing
such
ever.
A Nintendo thing. They're like, we have huge news. You can get a red controller.
The dog from Duck Hunt is in Super Smash Brothers.
The dog is in it.
Wait, what?
Yeah, the he's not as a playable character.
Oh, okay.
No. He's in it as a playable character.
How does that work?
Really? He can play as the fucking dog from Duck Hunt.
I thought he was just like one of the...
Nope,
like,
it's in he's wait, there and you can play as it.
How? What is the moveset?
It's a couple. He can spawn the hunter, like who you actually play as. There's a little sprite that pops up and it kind of like...
Did she know what I look like?
Acts like a sentry gun for like a minute, and it shoots. He can like throw ducks. He's basically just running
so
like melee.
He's
stuff.
Essentially not a tournament character at all. He's just there because
he's
boxing
the duck
goes.
Hunt dog. What do you mean? Yeah, he's a tournament character. He's the dog.
I'm just saying. I don't think he's.
No,
ever
I'm saying
use.
they're gonna add the duck. That's gonna be their news.
I think it's gonna be like it's gonna be one of their stupid like we have big news for an announcement on Monday,
mm-hmm.
getting people all in there excited, and then on Monday it's gonna be like, guys, there are big things coming for Nintendo. Stay tuned for quarter one, and that's gonna be pretty much it. Like
so
that's going to be what they do.
So if they're producing them in quarter two of 2016, then they're probably
holiday.
Planning
holiday.
To launch them
right before holiday, yep. like September,
which
October.
Is still a weird time for them to do it.
No, why it's would you think holiday is a weird time to
it's
launch
that,
a console?
Not that holiday is the fact that. It's the middle of the life cycle of the Xbox One and PS4.
Oh, God, they've been stuck on that for the last two generations.
I'm telling you.
You're just holding on to my Wii U needs to build in value.
Mine? I don't give a fuck. I don't give a fuck about my Wii U.
I'm telling you right now, the NX is coming out next holiday. It is launching with Zelda, and it's going to be a cross-generational thing. Zelda, Wii U, coming out on the same...
That doesn't bother me at all. I have no problem with that. I just think it's going to... Be weird. It's a weird time to launch a console.
Do you think it's not going to be successful?
No, I really don't.
Okay.
I really don't. As much as I would fucking love to see like Nintendo come out swinging and be like, we're back. Here's Zelda. Here's an HD console. It's just as powerful as this. Like, it's never going to fucking happen.
Does Conker come out with them? I'm back, bitches!
It's not going to happen. Like, they're too Nintendo anymore. Like, they're gonna come out and be like, hey, guys, and trip over themselves, and it's gonna fucking suck.
Derek just said Dean and Drew slap bet. I've talked with Dean about this before. I will never, ever slap bet Dean.
No,
because
I
imagine Dean being the Hawaiian guy from Forgetting Sarah Marshall that knocks a guy out with a slap.
I don't wanna slap anybody.
Anymore. I swear to God, he's got the heaviest hand I've ever seen. I high-fived him once, and I was like, what the hell did I just high-five? That was like a brick wall.
They're kind of feminine, I always thought. My fingers are, like, pretty thin.
You got a heavy hand, man.
I'll take it. I'm gonna take this.
I'm not slap betting Dean ever. Ever. Not gonna happen.
I'm not trying to slap anybody. I just think it's gonna be bad. I think it's gonna be bad. I want it to be good. In fact, if it does come out and it's getting positive buzz and they have Zelda, I'd be like, fuck this Wii U. I'm gonna get this and play Zelda on it. Fuck that
Spider-Man.
I don't know. I'm very apprehensive.
Or also known as the Superman pose now.
Also, yes.
Real apprehensive.
All right, Greg, take the final story, man.
You guys are crazy. Can I just say that before I bring the same story? Number one, number two, on Drew's tombstone, it's gonna read "Knack was awesome." I just love that.
You know what? I'm gonna stick by that till the day I die.
Whenever
when that game released, it was
out.
A fun game.
I liked it.
Knack literally comes up and Drew's just like, I love Knack. Oh, it just makes me laugh every time. I love it.
I've got no shame for that game.
It was I've never played it, so I can't judge it, but I just love how much
Knack gets a lot of flack, but I got no shame for that game.
Wow. Dr. Seuss in the room, ladies and gentlemen.
That's like a game that you would enjoy, I feel like.
Yeah, I just missed Knack because I didn't get my console right at launch. I got it mid-December at Toys R Us.
It's like a fun old-school platformer like Jak and Daxter, like Crash. And it looks amazing.
Are we still talking about Knack?
I'm talking about Knack.
You never played it, Greg?
No.
Oh, it's totally your style, man.
Yeah.
That's what Demon's just saying, yeah.
It's a fun diversion. Like, 8 hours, real quick.
Yeah.
Cough, trophy war, cough.
Yeah, for trophies, 100% worth it.
Ooh.
Do it.
I liked your pun there.
And also,
you're welcome.
Read the story.
All right. Yes, Master. Sorry, Master. Disney had plans for a Kingdom Hearts animated series. IGN's Alex Osborne writes, Square Enix and Disney had plans for a Kingdom Hearts television adaptation, but the project was ultimately canceled. Unfortunately for us, as revealed by Did You Know Gaming via Game Informer, an animated adaptation was put into production following the success of the first Kingdom Hearts, which released on PlayStation 2 back in 2002. Storyboard artist Seth Kearsley of Disney's television animation division was hired to write and direct a pilot for the potential series. Despite testing well with audiences, however, Disney and Square Enix decided to scrap the project because it was a, quote, vastly different interpretation, end quote, of the original game story. With plans for additional games, there was a concern the show would conflict with the overall plot. At the end of this story, my dilemma with this is, number one, a television show based on Kingdom Hearts, they could have totally done it without the main characters and it would have been beautiful and amazing, number one. Number two, that's what they were concerned about with confusing their plot, was a television show, not
right?
7,000 different games.
Well, this is where you draw the line, Square Enix? Like, not at 375 divided by 7.15 pi?
That's literally my point, though. It's like every game is a different divisional number where they're trying to figure out an equation that doesn't exist. But this is what's going to confuse people, so we can't make a television
show. Listen, I understand it, and I like this. I'm glad that this didn't happen.
No.
I would actually rather them wait until the entire saga is summed up and then bring it into a TV show.
I want a TV show.
I want a TV show too.
Give it
this
to me.
This is going to be right in the same vein, if they did it right, as Clone Wars, Star Wars The Clone Wars, and Star Wars Rebels, which, by the way, speaking of television shows, aka Fargo and The Leftovers that you need to watch, everybody, please fucking watch Star Wars Rebels.
It's on Netflix, right?
It's so good. Star Wars Rebels is not. It's current right now on Disney XD. But Star Wars Clone Wars, all six seasons, and the sixth and final season was Netflix only. So you can only catch the ending of Clone Wars on Netflix. So please,
Greg,
go do yourself a favor. It's so
we
good.
We had a question in the chat, and
yes.
I don't know the answer, so let's find out right now.
Okay.
Ghost Games wants to know, are you and Greg ever doing a Trophy Wars again?
Yeah.
Ooh. Should we even talk about this yet? I don't know if we're ready to talk about this yet.
I think we can definitively say whether or not we're going to do one.
We're doing a Trophy War. It's going to be a variation a little bit on last time, but more news to come on that later.
Yes.
There will be
another Trophy War.
We got some time.
And it's going to be even better than the first Trophy War. I'll tell you that right now.
It's going to be Greg's comeback.
What was that, Greg?
It's going to be Greg's comeback. It's going to be like Creed. It's going to be like Rocky kind of fizzled out.
Never mind. I'm not going to talk about it. Spoiler alert. I'm not going to talk about Creed.
I'm just going to stay quiet as a mouse this time and let you be your own worst enemy.
Greg, we need a game plan this time. Me and you are going to like sit down and talk about this for hours and come up with a perfect strategy. We're going to make a comeback.
It's hard to make a perfect strategy when you're fighting against perfection.
I thought you were just going to shut up and let Greg be his worst enemy.
That sums up Dean during Trophy Wars. He says one thing and he does the opposite.
Guys, Skype lines are live. Feel free to call in right now on Skype at the Level Up Show. Spelled exactly how it sounds, no spaces.
He never said he was
going to lose the Trophy War. Stay quiet as a mouse, everybody. Sorry you can't mess with perfection.
Wait, Greg, he never said he was going to lose the Trophy War, so how does he do the opposite?
Yeah.
Wait, what? No, I'm saying...
He's like, what? No, that's not what I said.
I'm talking about right now, Michael. Michelle, the Trophy Wars doesn't concern you right now. It concerns Dean going down. I'm delusional.
While we're waiting for a call here, guys, don't forget to follow us on twitch.tv/TheLevelUpShow. Did a 14 watching live from PlayStation. Jump over there. Go on the PS4 Twitch app if you have access. It's in the TV video area of your PS4. Download that bad boy. You know, log into your account and follow the Level Up Show. It's our more active, higher quality stream.
Super Dave says, I still have Mac.
What's that?
Big Benny.
Big Benny.
You meant to say sticker.
He's like, nice laptop, sucker.
Thanks. Thank you, son of a bitch. Appreciate that.
Riley, why are you pointing out Kilgrave? Why are you pointing out Kilgrave?
No, stop.
What's happening?
Can I hear him? Nope, I cannot.
No,
you
can't. I actually don't know. Hold on.
No, I know it's wrong. I know it's wrong.
I hate it more this way, Drew.
It's even creepier. Hold on one second, Brad.
I'm really, like,
it's trying to go to the Yeti speaker.
He looks like a frog choking on his spit. Look at him. He looks like a frog choking on his spit.
What's happening?
I still, like,
why can't I hear him? Hold on.
Hello?
Oh, there we go.
There we go.
What's going on, Brad? What do you want to talk about today?
PSX.
PSX? No, you're calling in too early. You're going to have to do that later. We're not ready to talk about PSX yet. Change your topic right now.
Christmas.
Christmas? I can talk about Christmas. We're about to show a Christmas trailer in just a moment.
Oh, yeah.
A movie trailer that's so Christmas-themed.
I'm guessing it's holiday-flavored. I'm guessing it's Krampus. Is that it?
What was it?
Krampus?
It's a good guess, maybe.
It's a good guess.
It's a very good guess.
It's almost exactly
I don't know why.
It's almost exactly right, yeah.
It's almost like somebody went to our website and looked at the outline.
Yeah.
It's like
Bradley, what did you ask Santa Claus for Christmas this year?
Oh my god. It's like I asked for I asked for a lot of stuff. A lot. Like,
well,
games.
Name one.
Game. Like, I want Just Cause 3. That's what I want.
Just Cause 3.
Yes.
I hear that the game is fun, but it's very buggy. Very buggy is what I heard as well.
Is it? Ooh.
Then, yeah. Heard crazy load times, like the longest load times you've ever seen.
And it's actually
crazy bugs.
Bad on Xbox versus PS4.
But I heard that the game itself, if they could just, you know, polish those things, maybe in a patch, is actually a lot of fun.
I hope they fix it soon, because I want that game.
Unfortunately, they laid off half of their team. Actually, three quarters of their team.
Ooh, bummer. Right around the holidays, too?
About 2 weeks ago.
Ugh, that's sucks. That's really sad. But no, I don't know what I would do on that one, Brad. I hear it's fun. I hear that they need to put a little extra work into that one there.
Yeah, it's either
you're taking a risk.
It's either that or might get maybe a Telltale game like Minecraft or what you call it, Back to Future, because I haven't played that one yet.
I heard that's one of the like the bummer Telltale games.
You just said the two worst Telltale games that were made.
I did hear that was pretty bad.
Have you played Tales from the Borderlands, Brad?
Nope.
That
is what you need to play then.
Okay. Yeah, is it on disc yet?
No.
And are you a Game of Thrones fan?
I've never watched it.
Oh, okay.
I started.
Right. Well, still, either way, I heard that was not too bad.
Fuck any game. You need to watch all the Game of Thrones.
Yeah, watch
the
TV show and then play the game.
I mean, you can do them individual, but there are characters that pop in on the game that you all have
no idea why.
The last thing I think I watched a bit of it, and this is from the first season when they pushed that kill at the window, when the brother and sister are having sex in the tower.
Best description ever.
That's a good description, yeah.
They were having sex. Meh.
That's a synopsis. That's like
right,
on my Comcast.
Pretty much
exactly what it says, word for word.
What? Sex?
Two people having sex in a tower.
Brother and sister have sex in a tower, and they push a kid.
Yep.
There's other good stuff. There's Mother of Dragons. They show her boobs for a while.
Yeah. First season only, though. Then she signed a contract saying no more.
Wait, are you saying that you didn't like it because of that?
This episode's so weird.
It's
off the rail so far.
It's me. I make the show weird.
You make everything weird,
makes
Brad.
The show. I make the show weird.
All right, man. We're gonna move on. Thanks for calling in, Brad.
Hey, Christmas tree. Can you see my Christmas tree?
I don't know what happened, dude. There's just arguments about trophy wars.
And I'm doing. Okay, see you later.
Level up.
Level up.
So I'm sorry. Everybody.
Why'd you guys talk about that in the first place?
I'm ruining everything, dude. I'm Final Fantasy.
Oh. Tobes resubscribing for 3 months. That is 1/4 of a year. If you guys
Big Benny also says that he just subbed, he or she.
Yeah, he might be mistaken for a follow. He probably followed us. Thank you, Big Benny, for following us, but you probably followed on the Level Up Network. Make sure to go to twitch.tv/TheLevelUpShow. What was that?
The
yeah, Big Benny called you a sucker.
Yeah.
Thanks for the follow.
All right, let's get back into the level update here so we don't fall far.
What?
Farts too far behind.
What the hell is going on?
We got a new t-shirt coming.
Incredible.
Oh, and never mind. We're actually going to do our... we were just talking about a trailer. Let's get to that
first. We've ever done.
Holly jolly it up.
Wait, what? What are we talking about?
Farting, apparently.
What is happening?
We're talking about farts, Greg.
It's the most wonderful time of the year. With the kids jingle bells.
Merry Christmas!
Looks like Martha Stewart threw up in here.
This is delicious, honey.
A little dry.
Well, mine's delicious.
Mine's dry.
Do you want to trade?
It's the Adam Scott's
Christmas.
Awesome.
It's Christmas. It's Christmas.
With those holiday greetings and gifts.
How are we going to survive Christmas with 12 people stuck in a house with no heat and no electricity?
Or food.
There's plenty of leftovers, Howard.
Beer it is.
It's the weirdest thing. There's no cars, no people.
My God, you never throw your letter from Santa away.
We heard something on the roof.
The hell is this?
St. Nicholas is not coming this year. Instead, a much darker ancient spirit.
Those are hooves. Elk?
Or a goat? What kind of goat walks on its hind legs?
His name is Krampus. He and his helpers did not come to give, but to take.
Everybody, hold on to each other.
He is the shadow of St. Nicholas.
Christmas. Nothing bad's gonna happen on Christmas.
If you guys don't know, the director also did Trick or Treat, which is a really, really great Halloween movie.
One of our friends actually already saw it, Dan Pietsch.
Oh, did he?
And he loved it.
Oh, Krampus.
Yeah, he saw Krampus.
It looks like the Grinch, his hand when it comes out. It's all like curly, like Grinch hands.
Yeah.
I'll go with that.
Yeah. Pretty accurate. Thanks, Greg. Greg, are you at all interested in that one?
Seeing it, not this Tuesday, but next Tuesday.
For a trashy, what's it called again?
Crappy Movie Tuesday.
What was it?
Crappy Movie Tuesday.
Crappy movie. I always want to say trashy.
I don't know why. I don't get dressed up in like a short black cocktail dress or anything. Go see the movie. Just go.
Maybe you should, Greg. Maybe you should.
I go as Trashy Movie Tuesday. I go in a trash bag. I'm okay with that.
Yeah, I think it looks like fun. I don't mind personally these kind of things. Dean was really offended by this earlier.
It's not offense. I just hate it. Like
everything needs to be. You just hate that everything needs to be gritty.
Exactly.
And
exactly.
I get that. This the reason I'm okay with this is because this is nothing new.
Right.
It's not like they invented this to fuck with.
No,
people.
But it's also like. It's just like, give it a fucking break. It's the one time of the year, dude, that everyone's like, not making these dark gritty, like, it's just fucking nice, and like, everyone's being friends and family, it's Christmas time. And they're like, nope, we're putting out the fucking Krampus. Like, come on. Just make a Christmas movie. Make a new Christmas movie. Where's Tim Allen at? He's not doing it.
Maybe we got enough Christmas movies coming out.
Right.
There's a few of them. You got The Night Before, which is like a comedy one. And then you got the horror one.
Oh, I need Krampus. To see that so bad.
I want to see that.
Yeah.
That was funny.
I need to see it really bad.
All right. Moving on. Level update part two. Let's get into it. First up.
Definitely don't want to fart behind. That was funny. I'm still thinking about it and almost like laughing. I can feel it.
PlayStation 2 remasters have been confirmed for the PS4. The first batch of PS2 games for PlayStation 4 are now available on the PlayStation Store, Sony revealed earlier this week. I'm excited to announce that you'll be able to purchase and play PS2 games on your PS4 via PlayStation Store in the Americas and Europe. SEE Worldwide Studios President Shuhei Yoshida said in a post on PlayStation Blog. Shoo! A total of 8 fan favorites will be able for purchase, including, this is probably the best in my opinion, Dark Cloud for $15.
Yes, that's good.
You also got Grand Theft Auto 3, Vice City, San Andreas, Rogue Galaxy, The Mark of Kree, all those 15, and then you've got Twisted Metal Black and War of the Monsters for $10. Each game will feature trophy supports, as well as up-rendered 1080p visuals. The titles will also support PlayStation 4's other key features, including remote play, live broadcast, share play, and activity feeds. So these are not just like emulation here. This is these are remasters.
So is this like the emulation news what it actually was? I'm just getting misconstrued, you think?
This is emulation. It is, but they are, since they're adding these features, there's more work being put into this, and that's why it's not like $5. Like they're $10 or $15, because there's a little bit more involved here.
Right.
Some upscaling, some they made it so that you can remote play, live broadcast, share play.
There's nothing yet for me that I'm like, yeah, gotta get it. Anything for you guys out of this?
No. Dark Cloud is great, but Dark Cloud 2 is where it was excellent. Dark Cloud 2 is such a good game.
If they do that Spider-Man 2 movie game, I'm gonna lose my fucking mind, dude.
What about the original?
With trophies, Spider-Man? Yeah.
I'd play that. I actually like the original.
I think that was my favorite out of all.
They're both very good.
I think what's really disappointing about this news, and I'm kind of surprised Sony didn't think of this or at least try to rectify this, you can't get your PS2 classics that you already bought on.
Right, and that's dumb to me.
And I guess it's because of this whole thing where it's about the trophy support, and they're not just giving you your PS2 classics back catalog. They're bringing new games to PS4.
But how many times
with trophy
do you need
support
to buy these games from them?
That's what's annoying.
You know,
yeah.
It's like, and I get it to an extent though. Like, yeah, you know, like, I don't know. It rubbed me the wrong way.
What, you guys in the chat, what is the one PS2 game that you would like to be remastered with trophies and 1080p visuals and all that good stuff? Let us know in the chat.
Halo, like, Modern Combat.
Get down some Spyro or something like that too, like an old school platform.
I was saying, actually, Danny, for some reason, Danny's really into Crash Bandicoot and Spyro right now.
Mm-hmm.
And Katie found her like a Crash Bandicoot
recently. Greg, do you have any PS2 games that you would love to come over? Oh, Greg, you must have muted your mic again. That's why we haven't heard you in a while. Like, actually, no, we can't hear you.
I like it.
Did you press the button on your Yeti? Now that I have one, I wonder if you accidentally pressed the button on your Yeti. No? All right, I'm going to have to call you back.
His just goes in and out. It happens a lot before we start doing power-ups, too. It happens.
Really? Yeah. Go ahead, Mike. I'll get Greg back set up.
You had to start the video, though.
Sure. You got it.
I mean, I can do it.
Nope, good. You're good.
Nintendo's NX won't be like the Wii or the Wii U. IGN's Alex Osborne writes, Nintendo isn't looking to create the next version of the Wii or Wii U with NX, according to President and CEO Tatsumi Kimishima. Instead, the company wants its next platform to offer something completely new. And Greg, we still can't hear you. I like this.
At all.
Oh, there we go.
Oh.
As far as NX goes, I've said it's different and obviously a new experience. Kimishima told Time. The Nintendo exec then spoke to the company's troublesome transition between the Wii and Wii U, noting how difficult it is to explain to the consumer base what is different and new about the new hardware. It's difficult to convince them to switch from their current platform to the next. Bearing this in mind, the company is taking a completely new approach with NX, aiming to offer something that is entirely different from its prior hardware. I can assure you that we're not building the next version of the Wii or Wii U. Kimishimi Mimima added, it's something unique and different.
That's racist.
It's
I got nothing on that. Dean just looks like it. Yep.
It's something unique and different. It's something where we have to move away from those platforms in order to make it something that will appeal to more of our customer base.
Boom.
I think they need to be talking about it. It's like, it's time to start telling people what it is, what it can do. Get people excited. You put it into mass production before you tell anybody what the fuck it is. I don't know if anybody cares.
Maybe that's tomorrow. I mean, we might, right?
Yeah, maybe. That's true.
I mean, if it's coming out next holiday, it's okay that they haven't revealed it yet, but it needs to be soon.
Yeah. I'll tell you what would be big if it comes out and it is just called, like, Nintendo.
That would be pretty cool.
I'm going to take that as the sign that, like, okay.
Reboot.
We're ready. We're doing this.
I think it would be cool if they brought back Super in some way.
That would be cool.
Even if it was the Super Wii.
The Super
Like,
Wii
not that I want Wii to come back as a name, but, like, if Super
they,
something.
The
Super
Wii U Cube. They're like, we're not building the next Wii U, and then it came out as Super Wii U. I'd fucking blow my
mind. I just want a Super Wii U Cube.
Yeah, that would be pretty backwards there. It's like an oxymoron. Super Wii U. That's an oxymoron right there.
I told you it wasn't the Wii U.
Go ahead, Dean, you're up. But this story, which was catered to you.
Yes, thank you. I'm so
excited. I do this for you, Dean.
I know. I notice. It doesn't go unnoticed. I appreciate it. WB Montreal is making two more DC Universe games. I can die happy. Game Informer writes, the studio behind Batman Arkham Origins is recruiting for two new games, both of them focused on expanding the DC Comics universe. According to the studio's site, the developer is looking to hire for a variety of positions tied to the upcoming AAA games. The exact properties within the DC brand aren't specified, but the studio's previous work might provide a hint. WB Montreal developed the Batgirl DLC for Rocksteady's Arkham Knight, and that piece of content hints at a Justice League villain, so that's one option. Another potential property is Suicide Squad. Both of those are the ones being rumored. A lot of people are throwing around Superman.
Mm-hmm.
I think if they do Superman, Rocksteady is going to be the one to
stab
at that.
If we're going to get another Superman game, it needs to be given to like an established, like great developer who's actually going to do it right.
What would you feel about either a Cyborg or an Aquaman game?
I mean, it depends, I guess. It depends what it looks like. It depends what they're going with in terms of the gameplay.
Yeah, I'm open to anything.
I feel like Cyborg would actually not be a bad route for video games, just because there is upgrades. It's not like, Superman, congratulations, you upgraded your laser vision.
I think as much as we think that would be cool.
Like, they could start off the game where, like, you know, he was weakened by in some capacity, and he's slowly gaining his strength back.
Here's the thing, we think that would be cool, because we know the more, I don't even want to call them obscure, but the lesser known characters, they're going to go with characters that are well established, known to the mainstream audience. That's why they're going to do a Superman or a Justice League. Like, they're going to go with one of those well established characters. Do you agree, Greg?
I'm seeing them going more towards the Suicide Squad theory. To me, is the one that's most likely, especially because the last game that they did work on was Arkham Origins, and spoiler alert for Arkham Origins, even though it's been out forever now. At the end of that game, the after credit sequence, they go and they find Deathstroke in his jail cell, and they hand him a file as if they're recruiting him. So I totally see them going the Suicide Squad route, especially with the movie coming out. I just feel like that's kind of smart on their part, advertising-wise, to push that out, maybe if they get that out at the same time. And they haven't been doing anything besides the Batgirl DLC that we know about, but obviously they have two more games coming. I don't see them doing a Justice League or anything big. It just doesn't make sense.
I'm surprised none of you guys said Red Hood.
No.
No.
I don't see them doing
Red
Hood. I would love to see them do a Batman Beyond game.
Right.
We just got Red Hood and Arkham Knight. It wasn't, but it was, you know, kind of Red Hood.
And I don't really think, like the Red Hood is strong enough to carry an entire game.
I agree.
Yeah.
The most obscure I could see them going, which is not even that obscure, is probably Green Arrow, just because it lends itself so well to that, the gameplay, the assets that they already have.
But
it's another like kind of detective Batman, you know, a character.
And
so,
even like the grappling and stuff, he's got like the arrows swinging around. That makes so much sense.
What about Green Lantern?
Fuck yeah, dude! If they can do it,
cool. I still think they need to go with like the Justice League one, where you can choose what hero tackles the issues at any given time.
They can easily do a Justice League game. Just look at, they need to look at Grand Theft Auto, the way you can swap from character to character.
That would be awesome.
Yeah.
I'm still seeing, realistically, I don't think they're getting any big solo superheroes. My fingers are crossed and hoped for, because I still think these are big properties, but I just think that they would be given them. Either Batman Beyond or Teen Titans, I think is what's going to be.
Both of those would be so rad.
Batman Beyond would be amazing.
Batman Beyond would be cool.
That's such a good show.
I have a theory that, the most recent DLC that they came out with, one of the Arkham episodes, was all about Tim Drake as Robin. Spoilers for Arkham Knight.
Yeah.
It's about after the events of the game, and he's really down on himself, he's always hard on himself, he's got Barbara on his comm, always like, you're not him, and he's like, he would have done this, he's like, I'm not fast enough yet, he's like, he would have done this way, and blah, 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 and like, they kind of are setting him up to seem like he's trying to, like, build himself to get there. So, like, I'd be down for a Robin game where he's, like, getting ready to take up the mantle, you know?
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
That'd be really cool.
There are so many, like, potential great ideas. DC, I think DC is awesome. Like,
DC
they're,
is awesome, dude.
They're, you know, roundup of characters.
Yeah.
What was that, Greg?
I said they're my favorite.
Yeah, I'm more of a DC guy personally, to be honest with you.
Marvel's killing it right now, but DC's villains and their storylines, I think, are just more intriguing to me.
I think DC's got better villains, hands down. Yeah. Well, Batman specifically.
Yeah.
Batman's got the best villains by far.
I mean, even though we got Brainiac, you got both, dude. I love Darkseid. You got, I mean, you got a lot of really good ones overall that aren't just Batman oriented.
Gorilla God, Reverse Flash. Flash is showing good light on them.
Gorilla God is actually, I think, one of the weakest. I mean, it's a good villain, but I feel like it's just like
at the end of the day,
we need a villain. All right, well, what do you want to make him? A gorilla.
Yeah.
All right. I mean, make him smart though. Okay. Like, I don't know. It's kind of weak to me. But no, overall, I do feel like DC has a lot of really good ones.
DC is awesome. Yeah.
Greg, why don't you take the last story, man?
On it. For a limited time, PlayStation Now is $99.99 for a one-year subscription. IGN's Alex Osborne writes, starting December 8th, Sony will be offering a 12-month subscription option for the PlayStation Now. According to the PlayStation blog, this limited-time offer grants access to the cloud-based streaming service for just $99.99, providing a savings of over 55% off the standard monthly price. In addition, Warner Brothers is bringing several of its titles to the PlayStation Now service this coming Tuesday, including Batman Arkham Asylum and Arkham Origins, as well as Mortal Kombat, Injustice, Gods Among Us, and a host of LEGO games. Which is really cool.
The newest Mortal Kombat game.
I'm not sure which Mortal Kombat it is. That's 9, isn't it? That's when they restarted the franchise, Mortal Kombat 9, and then this most recent one was Mortal Kombat 10 X. Mortal Kombat X.
Oh, okay.
So that's the one that came out on PS3 and Xbox 360. This is pretty wild, though. I mean, for a month, it's $20. For 3 months, it's $45. So if you extrapolate there, 20 times 12, that's $240, and now we're getting it for $99.99. As it said there, 55% discount. That's huge.
Yeah.
What was it monthly before this?
20.
And it's still $20 a month.
No, now it's like $8 a month.
That's awesome.
That's a freaking discount there. Yeah, like, that's huge. Everybody, remember when we announced PlayStation Now, everybody's like, oh, no, this should have been Netflix prices. Well, Netflix. Now it's cheaper than Netflix, actually. Yeah, right. If you go with HD Netflix is $10 a month. This is cheaper, and you're getting games streamed. Mm-hmm. If they can get the catalog better, I think this is a great service for that price.
Yeah. I hear a lot of feedback that like some of the frame rates are iffy. Like as far as like.
All depends on your connection, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, I know. Greg, didn't you try it out and said it worked perfectly?
Yeah, it worked really, really well. I did. God of War Ascension on PS Now. I did The Last of Us a bit, and there was one that I just tried like a month ago. I'm forgetting the game. It was really good, though. It was your internet connection, as long as it's solid, it's basically you can test it off if you do SharePlay. So if your SharePlay connection is not stepping for your friends at all, the PS Now connection is just as solid as that, because you're not connecting to anything else online. So
I heard the bigger issue is not so much frame rate, it's a little bit of latency. Okay. So certain games just kind of don't make sense. Like if it's a fighting game, you're going to feel that latency. Right. But if you're playing like an RPG, you'll be fine. It's good.
I'm going to try it out. I still have that like free trial. They give you that week free trial.
Yeah, that's for everybody. Everybody can get a 7-day free trial if you want to try it out. Just make sure that you unsubscribe. I think they will automatically charge you after the 7 days if you don't keep track of it. I hate that. That's so annoying.
That does suck.
All right, let's open up the Skype lines. Feel free to call in right now, guys, on Skype at the Level Up Show, spelled exactly how it sounds, no spaces. We talk all things gamer-related. Anything going on in the chat, Greg?
Everyone's saying, wow, that's such a good deal. That's such a good price. No one's saying that they are going to pick it up, though.
That's the thing, right? Is like everybody complained at the beginning, like, it's too expensive. I would get it if it wasn't so expensive. Like, guys, it's now $8 a month, technically. Like, if you wanted it then, get it now.
I still think it's a thing that they should include with PS Plus somehow.
Oh, I 100% agree, yeah.
Like, if you do make it $8 a month, like, make it, like, every PS Plus user gets PlayStation Now for an extra, like, $10 onto the PS Plus subscription. I just think that's a better way to do it.
That would be a crazy deal.
Yeah, that's a little too much. I was thinking more like $100 a year for PS Now and PlayStation Plus, because then PS Now goes down to $50 in a year, which is, I think, insane.
Yeah.
To get a whole year of PS Now for $50, I think that would be great for PS Plus guys. I think $60 for both is ridiculous and never going to happen. $100? Maybe. But probably still not.
I think it would be cool if, even if it could only be for like Sony, like studio movies, if they gave you like free rentals on like Sony movies.
I would use that. That would be cool. With the games.
Yeah. Infinite757 asks, can you play online with PlayStation Now? I don't think you can.
No, you cannot.
I don't know much. I tried it when it was in beta phase. I got invited to the closed beta and I played Guacamelee on it a little bit. And it,
That's a fun game.
It was good. I love Welcome Melee. It was good in the beta phase, so like I can't imagine how it is like as a finished polished
product. Hey, Zach.
This guy.
Genko Swag, hey. Welcome back to the show. How you doing, man?
Pretty good. Pretty good. I just got back from work, actually. It's pretty late.
Is this why you make the big bucks, Zach?
No.
The long hours? What's going on, man? What do you want to talk about?
I'm sure you guys... I just tuned in, so I'm sure you guys already talked about it, but I just read something on Twitter about Final Fantasy VII being episodic.
Yep. That's what we're going to get to.
Get out of here, really?
Yep, and Mel is trying to call in right now to talk about it. We're going to talk about it a lot later, because I am ready to flip shit over this. But the thing is, I'm still trying to hold on to some optimism. We don't know exactly what that means yet, but that's not good news. What do you think? What's your feeling on it?
For me personally, I think it's I'm not good at playing those 40 to 80 hour games. So I feel like it'd be pretty nice to just, you know, get me through the game episodically, you know.
And it might mean that we get it earlier, right? The first episode might come out next year, for instance.
I feel like there's like, oh, maybe they'll just get off our backs.
I feel like the thing that makes the most sense, if you've played Final Fantasy VII, you know this, Midgar is like the first 10 hours of the game. Yep. That's like a perfect episode.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to save this discussion more in depth for later on. That, I think, would be okay, but there are certain ramifications of that would not be okay. But I don't know if that's the case. Like, I'll speculate on that later on in the show. But there are certain ways where this could completely destroy what made the original so great. So I'm optimistic in some ways. I think it looked great what we saw at PlayStation Experience. We're going to be playing that trailer later on. But overall, my immediate response to this was hype train crashing into a wall.
No.
Yeah, like the hype train was full speed ahead, choo-choo motherfuckers, and then like it just smashed into a wall.
Yeah, that's a
problem. Oh, man.
That was my immediate reaction when I saw this. Like, right, like an hour before our show is when I saw this.
Did they mean episodic?
Yeah, it was just like, like, it was just, oh, man. So, yeah, I don't know, man. We'll get more in depth there with that one. Are you a big Final Fantasy VII fan, Ginkgo?
I've tried to. I have the game, but I don't know. I just can't get through it, I guess.
Well, maybe the remake will be more your style, especially if it's episodic. Maybe it might be a structure that's more fitting to your schedule.
That's the other thing. I watched PlayStation Experience, and it's just Kingdom Hearts with... What?
He said, I'm sorry, because he doesn't think PSX was too great. What'd you think?
Oh, no, I agree. It was terrible. I didn't like it. I mean, how do you end on a MOBA? Like, this
oh, my God.
Up.
Not even how do you end on a MOBA? How do you mic drop, essentially? Like, that was their intention.
I don't know. That's actually, I mean, I watched it, and it's not a game for me, but that's kind of a big deal.
The crowd didn't give a shit.
I don't know. You can't really hear the crowd, because they turn off, like, the crowd mics, and they turn on the game stereo.
No, in between, you could hear the crowd. It was silent.
Yeah, it's Epic Games, exclusive to PlayStation, with a MOBA, which is huge right now. I don't know.
It's cool, but, I mean, that's not
it's not, and Ni No Kuni was
it
the
wasn't
the mic drop for
what,
me.
No, Final Fantasy VII gameplay trailer should have been last.
Yeah.
Ni No Kuni should have been in place where Final Fantasy VII was.
They should have started with Uncharted, they should have done a 1-2 punch at the end with Final Fantasy VII Remake, and then be like, oh, one more thing, Ni No Kuni as well.
Or that
would have been, like, the closer.
Hey, definitely right. Shuhei came out and, you know, did Ni No Kuni, too.
Ni No Kuni is
amazing. Even up there.
What was that? Sorry?
Mm-hmm.
What was that? I'm sorry, I missed the last part there.
Oh, Shuhei Yoshida. I can't believe he didn't even show up.
Yeah. He wasn't there. There was a bunch of people.
It was weird.
It wasn't like, it wasn't for PlayStation people. Like, the way they ended that was like, maybe you can get away with that shit at E3 where there's like a variety, but like, this was for PlayStation.
No, it was a PlayStation exclusive, console exclusive.
Yeah,
at the
right,
MOBA.
But he brought up a good point.
Like
it's all third party.
Who play on PlayStation, like,
yeah, there was a lot of third party stuff.
We don't give
there.
A shit, dude. Like, we don't give a shit. We want to see PlayStation. Like,
we can see this stuff easily at E3.
Right.
This is, we came for PlayStation.
At the same time, like, I know we get so excited for these kind of things. This is something extra they're doing
no,
for us.
No, you're right. But
like, we didn't get this 2 years ago.
Yeah, but that's not an excuse anymore.
Right.
I think
it
is.
As well as they did last year.
When they did it last year, we weren't even sure they were going to do it again, remember? It wasn't until a few months later where they confirmed, yeah, we're going to continue doing PlayStation Experience. We were like, oh, this is just a 20th anniversary thing. This is a one-year deal. It's like, cool, we got this for 1 year. That was awesome. Now we're getting PlayStation Experience supposedly every year. I think we should be just thanking our lucky stars that we get something in December.
It's not that I'm ungrateful for it, but you can't sit there and be like, hey, you should be happy that it was there at all. Don't be mad because it wasn't good. Like, you can't say
it
that.
It wasn't bad.
I think it was bad.
It wasn't. Okay, we'll talk about this later. We got to talk about this later. Ginkgo, thanks for calling in, man.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
All right, level up, man.
Level up.
All right. Should I wait for Mel? Mel, why don't you call in a little later? I'm definitely taking your call later when we get into the main Final Fantasy VII meets.
Why don't we do this next?
Yeah, let's do our on-the-spot first, all that good stuff, and then we'll get into the TGAs and the PSX news.
We need to make a t-shirt that says hashtag choo-choo motherfuckers.
Choo-choo motherfuckers.
We're just Drew's face on train.
Everyone wrote that.
Can we just make Drew's face on train?
Yeah, 100%. Just I'll be the face. I'll be like Thomas the Tank Engine, but it's my face instead.
I need this in my life.
Greg. All right. Next up on the spot. Guys, you can go on our Twitter at the Level Up Network, level spelled LVL, and tweet at us with hashtag on the spot if you want to be a featured question on our Sunday night shows, or if you want to be on IODP next week, you use hashtag IODP. This week's question, dear the Level Up Show, which video game do you feel has told the best story? Sincerely, Mr. Rager 909. This is a broad question, but I feel like it goes multiple ways. It's which video game do you feel like has the best story, and which video game do you feel told the best story? Those are kind of two different questions,
right? Like the way in which they told?
Yes, right? Yeah. Like the storytelling versus the story itself. Because some games have an awesome story like told in the background through sometimes like written stuff. Mm-hmm. It could be journals or something like that. But then you have a game that tells a good story. So let's start with just story overall. Like the game itself, the world, the story. What's the best story game?
I mean, there's two obvious ones. I feel like that's going to be brought up right now. Last of Us and Walking Dead.
See, Last of Us for me is all about the storytelling.
Mm-hmm.
That is the best storytelling I've ever seen in a game. Because of the production value, because of the voice acting, the direction of the cutscenes, the pacing of the game. Mm-hmm. Like, that's Naughty Dog at its best. That's how you tell a story that is, in some ways, kind of cliche. I mean, that's just Children of Men meets a lot of other movies. Like, it's kind of cliche in a lot of ways, but it was told so well.
The story itself is like, it's in a zombie apocalypse story.
Pretty generic for the most part. It does some cool twists and turns. It has a great ending.
Yeah.
It's all about how well that story is told. But I agree, that should definitely be in the running. Anything else that comes to your mind?
Immediately.
How about you, Greg, since...
The thing, when you said especially to like the world itself and building up their characters, I think Kingdom Hearts is a great representation of not their story. Like Sora's story is so convoluted and crazy, and the whole idea of the Keyblades and stuff. But what I really appreciate about Kingdom Hearts is that they included the Disney characters and the big iconic properties. But if you notice, in all of those worlds, kind of what like Hercules and Aladdin and Tarzan, what they're all kind of going through mirrors. What Sora is going through at that time in his life. And even as you go through each world, like maybe he saw a glimpse of Kairi in the Lost Jungle, but then by the time you get to Neverland and you're flying around with Peter Pan, like you get to a point where you're like Sora's kind of accepting that like his friends are kind of leaving him, and Peter Pan's kind of going through the same thing, and like, oh, I don't have the Lost Boys anymore. Like it all kind of mirrors his story, and that
I agree.
Really appreciated.
Yeah, that's all about story structure, right? And that was a tough thing to do with a Kingdom Hearts, like with that idea of doing all these different Disney worlds. Like, how do you have this cohesive story running in the background when it's all about just jumping from world to world? That's a tough thing to do, and I do agree with the first Kingdom Hearts especially. That's why I like the first one more than the second one. It felt cohesive.
And as far as, like, the best story ever told in games, like, the first one that jumped out at me was BioShock. Like, I remember playing that for the first time, and, like I played that all the way through, and, like, everything scared the hell out of me, and I didn't get what was going on. And then when it finally got to the end of it, I was like, holy shit, dude. Like, that was the first time I was genuinely shocked by a game, where I was like, wow.
Were you BioShocked?
I was BioShocked. it was really good, though. I enjoyed it.
There's three for me overall.
Okay.
Grim Fandango. Just because, I mean, it's all story game, but it's entertaining. It keeps you engaged. Even at times we have no idea what you're supposed to be doing, and it's something that doesn't help further the story. It helps build the character up and build the environment. So overall, the entire part of it's great. Fable.
Okay.
That's a game that has a huge lore that builds up from the lore, and even though it constantly evolves and changes, it's still... keeps current and it keeps you invested and makes you think and change and choose. But overall, I would have to say probably BioShock Infinite.
That was great.
Probably be the best story.
Yeah, I feel like the ending to Infinite especially is great. That's a great ending.
Yeah.
I agree.
I thought it was perfectly well done. As far as being told to, I think Ori and the Blind Forest has a great way of doing it. It's a short game, but it grabs you in. It makes you invested. I know it's a lot about the art and the music, but it's also the story and the way that they told it. Because they use those pieces to bring it all together and make everything flow well. And there's no spoken word. It's all written on the screen, but you're invested in it. And even by the end, you're just like, please don't let this happen. Don't, again, twice in one, fuck you. Like, it really grabs you.
There's so many ways this could go for me. I feel like I have to mention a lot of old Japanese RPGs are so good. Chrono Cross comes to mind, not in the way that it's told, but if you really like nail down into like the time traveling and all the paradoxes and it just how much work had to be put into that story, Chrono Cross has to be mentioned. We talked about earlier 6 and 7 for Final Fantasy. Those are the best when it comes to stories, in my opinion. Both excellent stories. Two other ones that I feel need to be mentioned because they do story differently. Shadow of the Colossus tells the story through the world. I really like that about Shadow of the Colossus, and it has a really cool twist at the end as well. That definitely needs to be mentioned. Journey being the other one. Minimalistic story, entirely told through, I don't even know how to...
Images?
Through the environment, kind of like Shadow Colossus, but also through this relationship with this partner you have, and also the ambiguity of the ending. It allowed everybody to kind of form their own story for that game. Like, that game touches everybody differently. Like, you either apply it to your own life in some way. So, that's a story that you kind of tell yourself in a lot of ways. And I think that's something that isn't done very often in games. And that's why I feel like that one should be mentioned.
Yeah.
What about you, Dean?
Both Bioshock 1 and Bioshock Infinite were both two big ones for me. The Wolf Among Us, I love that story. The story was so good.
Mm.
That was one of the few of, like, the episodic games where I was like, you had to keep... You were like, what's going to happen? I love that story so much. Infamous 1, I really enjoyed the story. They had a great, great twist to the ending. I think Infamous 1 story deserves more credit than it gets, because it is kind of like tropey and like it's a superhero tale. But like some of the shit they do with the characters is really interesting.
The twist is great. Yeah, it's one of the best twists in games.
And then obviously Super Mario Brothers, best story of all time.
Yeah,
hands down.
We still don't know why the hell he's taking Princess Peach.
I think he's exercising. I think Super Mario is exercising and.
Okay, give a straight face on that one. No,
you know what I did forget? I forgot one.
Go ahead.
But it's a little bit. It hasn't aged as well. But Time Splitters Feature Perfect was probably one of the better ones because it involved a lot of time travel, but interconnectivity in the time travel. Usually in Time Splitters, you went back to this time, but this one you interacted with yourself a lot of times, and they set that up very, very well. Both the dialogue that they had, especially with, you know, not only with other characters, but with your character. When you meet face-to-face, this guy is kind of like a big hung like Kronk almost a little bit, but a little bit more intelligent.
Okay.
And so, but the dialogue as well as how they made everything intertwine, and they didn't ever trip over themselves at all, that was in along the same lines of when you said Chrono Trigger.
Yeah, I love time travel, and I think it's a really tough thing to do well. That's why I feel Chrono Cross does a great job with the time travel.
I said Chrono Trigger.
You said Chrono Trigger?
Yeah,
Chrono Cross is actually the one I think is a little bit more... It's convoluted, but it really tells an amazing story when you like really research it and read up on like all the things that happen in that game. Yeah. But great question. Thank you so much, Mr. Rager, for the
quick
question.
Quick special shout-out to two more. Life is Strange, obviously. I was just trying to think of like... older games, that's why I didn't think of anything recently. And then also, really big shout out, and if you haven't played this game, especially the DLC, is very, very good for it. Never Alone, it was free for PlayStation Plus, and the way they tell that story through, like,
the
Eskimo heritage and stuff, they do it through, like, videos of, like, the extra tribes that go into it. It's phenomenal.
The way they tell that one is really cool. Yeah. I'm with you on that.
Cool.
Yeah.
Thanks again, Mr. Rager. And I saw another really good question from today. I think we'll use that one next week. There was like two questions that were submitted like right before the show today. I didn't not see them. I saw them. We will use them in future episodes because there were some good ones in there. All right, let's take a quick commercial break, and then we will get into the topic of the week, which is the Game Awards and PlayStation Experience. So hold on tight. We'll be back in 60 seconds.
Super Dave, M. Provoball said Knack has the best story.
Knack. It's a charming, cute story. It's not. It doesn't blow any minds, but it's cute.
Is it weird that, as much as I thought about that question and all the games I thought about, everyone's saying, like, Uncharted in the chat room, like, when it first got asked, but, like, I don't think... Like, I love Uncharted stories, don't get me wrong, and I love those games, but, like, I don't think those stories are, like... like they made such an impact on me. Like The Last of Us like left scars.
You know, I think if you're talking about Naughty Dog games, they all told in a great way, and that's what we're talking about, storytelling. Yeah. But if you're going to go to Naughty Dog games, it's The Last of Us. That's the opposite.
Okay.
Phantom Pain, definitely not. Metal Gear Solid 1 and Snake Eater probably should have been mentioned by me for sure. Those are two great stories. Infinite, is that what you were reading, Infinite?
Well, he said that before, so I just said, I said Phantom Pain on purpose. But
yeah, Metal Gear definitely should be mentioned in there. Some of the original ones were amazing when it comes to the story. People are seeing commercials and like, no! Sorry, guys.
I think if they were able to make the twist in Arkham Knight not so obvious, I would have said that. Mm-hmm. Because even the way that they connected all the side missions into the story in that game was really clever. But like, it was just that could have been such a huge twist if it was anybody else under that hood.
Yeah.
Under that mask. And like, it was just too obvious.
We all knew it was coming
from... It literally could have been anybody else.
I didn't know it was coming from us, but I knew within...
We kind of all said it, though. We said it multiple
times.
2 hours
into the story playing the game. You guys had guesses,
you had a spoiler. Yeah.
But when I played the game, I was like, well...
It was the only one that made sense, so we were all... Here's the thing. It made so much sense that for a while, we said it. Months prior, we were all speculating about it.
Yeah.
And then we were like, well, it can't be because it's too obvious, right? They're kind of teasing it, and we're like, it can't be that. Oh, no, it is.
Yeah, surprise. Exactly.
I feel like just because the twist like didn't land and it was kind of predictable, I don't think I should hold that against the story. The story's good, but no.
And it's told really well, too.
It was told very well. It's just, it didn't land fully. It could have been brought to...
The way they integrated Joker into the story as a device and not as a character coming back, like that's what I really liked about the Joker in that game, is that he was with you the whole time. He's with you through the entire game.
It was kind of like Patty from The Leftovers.
Yeah, it kind of is. Yeah, you're right. It is like Patty. It's like it's like Tyler Durden or and any of those, like, it's a split personality that's with you throughout the game and is paralleling what's going on. Mm-hmm. It was really well done. I thought that was really smart of them to integrate the character in that way without bringing back.
P.S. We're at 94 people.
Really?
Yeah.
94?
Not 94.
It says 54. Okay.
Mine says 94.
Yeah. Really? Awesome. That's the highest we've ever been on the PC stream. We're doing it, guys. We're doing it, Peter.
I feel like that's such a defeating thing, though. It's like, hey, we used to be at 400.
We knew.
It's all about building it back.
We're starting fresh. We're kind of rebooting in a way. So that's awesome. Thank you for joining us, everybody. Don't forget to hit that follow button if you're watching at twitch.tv/TheLoveLoveShow.
Now I'm skeptical.
And welcome back.
Up, and there's the bot.
Is it a bot?
I don't think.
Or we got raided.
If it keeps just like,
yeah,
we could be getting
going higher and higher.
There's definitely 127 names in the list.
Okay, cool. If you guys are joining us, thank you so much for joining us. This is the Level Up Show, episode 102, a gaming dedicated talk show on every Sunday at 10 p.m. Eastern Time. We talk all things gaming related. We're about to get into our topic of the week, which is the Game Awards and PlayStation Experience. We're going to start with the Game Awards since that was first in the week.
We did hit 100, by
the way. And we hit 100!
Because
it was a big one. We've never hit 100 before.
Now it's at 200.
Now, all right.
Okay, never mind. Bummer.
Womp.
It is what it is.
The 100 seems real. I don't know about 200. 100 seems real.
Okay, it doesn't matter. Moving on. Let's go through who won first, and then we'll get into the game premieres. Here are all the winners at the Game Awards. Best Family Game goes to Super Mario Maker. You got Best Fighting Game for Mortal Kombat 10. Best Multiplayer Game, Splatoon. Best Mobile Game, Lara Croft Go. Best Esports Game, Uptick Gaming. Never heard of that. Best Esport Player, Optic. Kenny. Good for you, Kenny. Best Esport Game.
Get him, Ken.
I don't even know who that is.
Way to go, Kenny.
And it doesn't even have a last name. It's just Kenny. Best Esport Game, Counter-Strike Global Offensive. Most Anticipated Game went to No Man's Sky. That was voted by you, the gamers. Best Narrative went to Her Story. That was interesting. Most Trending Gamer, Greg Miller. Congrats to Greg Miller.
We were very happy. And you watched this, right?
So well-deserved, yes.
Yeah, you were with us when we knew. Yeah, I forgot.
Supposedly, he totally knew he was going to win that. I don't know how. Supposedly he was able to check out the statistics of like the hashtags, and he knew he was like 67% of the votes.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, like so he knew the whole time. He was playing like he didn't know, but he knew the whole time. That's great. I think is what I read. So that's awesome. Congrats to Greg Miller. Best indie game went to Rocket League. That was a tough one because Ori was a huge...
But Rocket League was one of those ones I was like, if it's going to lose, Rocket League is the only one that I'm okay with.
Rocket League is fucking awesome, dude.
It is.
That game is so good.
But that's why I'm surprised that Rocket League lost to Splatoon for multiplayer.
Yeah. Well,
it has much more support.
It won best sports racing game, went to Rocket League. So, you know, kind of competitive there. It won two awards, indie and sports racing. So it was a good night for Rocket League. Most impact game, Greg, Life is Strange. You went mute again, Greg.
Yes, thank God you went mute for that part. You see him ramping up for that? That would have been so obnoxious.
He was clapping. He was ready to go. Greg, I'll call you back, man. Hold on one sec.
That face was amazing.
Hold on one sec, Greg.
I'm going to start that soon. Life is Strange.
It's so good.
I'm kicking myself for not buying it when it was $10.
You should have. I bought it when it was $20 and then it went on sale for $10.
I know.
I don't regret it, though.
I'm debating. I'm either going to buy that or...
You're back, Greg. You're back. Now you can flip out.
I did so much. Wow!
Wait, hold on one sec. I want to switch it back to original version.
You don't have to rehash.
Deserving of it more than any other game.
Deserving of it more than any other game. I agree. It's really great. Very impactful. Best fan creation went to Portal Stories. Developer of the Year went to CD Projekt Red, best known for Witcher, of course. Best role-playing game went to The Witcher 3 Wild Hunts. Mm-hmm. Best art direction went to Ori and the Blind Forest. Very well-deserved. Mm-hmm. Unbelievable artwork in that game. Up next...
Still my background on my laptop, too.
Industry icon, Westwood Studios. When you were watching this, were you hoping that Mike Legg would show up on the screen?
I did, and you know, it kind of bummed me out. And it's funny, because Pasta the entire time was like... He owes me a fucking code.
Yeah.
Hey, you, I need a code for Command. Like, that's all he was saying. But no, I was kind of hoping he would come on stage because that would have been really cool to see him. But I guess his partner was more deserving.
Yeah, I guess so.
I don't know.
Whatever. Best action adventure game went to Metal Gear Solid V, The Phantom Pain. Best soundtrack went to Metal Gear Solid V, The Phantom Pain. Best performance went to Viva Seyfort from Her Story. That was a funny moment. Jade Raymond, for some reason, said The Witcher. Supposedly it was because it said that on the card. And the game of the year went to The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt, the big one, game of the year. I want to go back first to best action adventure game, Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain.
Back before that, actually.
Sure.
Up at the top, the first one.
Best family game?
No, I'm sorry. Where is it? Best narrative.
Best narrative went to Her Story.
Really threw me.
Well, I haven't played this game. I hear a lot about it. Mm-hmm. It's like a... You're checking out video, like a...
Right, now here's my thing, though. This was the controversial one where many people were like, it's only okay.
Really? Right? I've heard it's really good.
I heard it was pretty good.
Okay, yeah. So that I thought this was the one where everybody, like, the critic reviews were great, but the player reviews, the people were like, it's just okay, guys.
Everyone that I know that's played the game said that it was, like, really, really good, like, story-wise.
Okay, so maybe I'm just hearing the wrong one, or maybe I'm thinking of the wrong game. So
I'm hearing, like, Gone Home type thing in this game when it comes to, like, the story it's telling.
Same, yeah.
Which makes me want to play it. Maybe I will someday.
It's on console?
It's charming.
No, I think it's only on PC, Steam.
Only
I
PC
think.
Right now, yeah.
Yeah, hopefully it comes to console. That would be great. I wanted to go to Metal Gear Solid V, The Phantom Pain, winning Best Action Adventure Game because we were all surprised when Kiefer Sutherland walked up on stage to accept that award. We were all like, wait, Hideo Kojima's in the freaking audience. Why isn't Hideo Kojima accepting this award for his game? Yep. That award ends, and suddenly Geoff Keighley's front and center, and he's like, Hideo Kojima was supposed to accept this award. We had all expectations of him being here, but... Lawyers from Konami have told us that he was not allowed to come due to contractual stuff. And then everybody in the audience starts booing. Mm-hmm. Everybody on Twitter, hashtag fuck Konami, rightfully so. This was, I don't even know what to say to this. Like, it's just mind-blowing.
I'm going to put this out there right now. I think Geoff Keighley knew this. Prior to the show. I don't think he knew this much, like, he had much of a... You know, heads up. But I feel like, because he was letting this in, like, he's coming, he'll be here.
Yeah.
It'll be great. And then I feel like he knew for at least a day, if not a couple days.
He used it as a way to say fuck Konami. He totally used it as a dig moment.
This was, and it was perfect.
It was great.
I love him even more for it.
Yeah, I'm really happy he did that. And then, I don't know if it was planned. I have to imagine it was to have, God, what's her name? She played Quiet. Stephanie Houston, or Houston. She came out to do a quiet song, which was a really cool moment. It was dedicated to Hideo Kojima. I think that was already planned to be there, but it was great that it kind of followed that moment up. Yeah. Right after that, it followed it, and it kind of gave a little bit of acknowledgement.
Best meme ever. It had a picture of Jeff Keighley, and like it's right before he started the speech, and it was kind of like... It was like that moment when you know you're about to blow up Hideo's Twitter feed.
Yeah,
it's like that's so true. Dude.
Yeah,
like, so awesome. He knew that bomb was about to drop.
We almost couldn't focus after that happened because we were just so enraged.
Yeah, it was really fucking crazy.
It really threw off the entire night.
I can't wait. Can't wait until they are like just washed from this industry. Like, get the fuck out.
They're so afraid, dude. They're so fucking afraid of when he no longer is contractually obligated to not talk about.
I love it. I can't wait.
They're so afraid. And when it happens, I hope he goes nuts.
Yeah, yeah. Easily.
I want to know every little detail of what happened.
What would you do if he named not Shinra, the freaking...
Shinra?
Shinra.
The big bad fucking Shinra.
For Metal Gear Solid, the corporation.
Foxhound.
He just changed every one of his games. He just patched every one of his games, and Foxhound just was renamed Konami.
I can't wait, man. I can't wait to find out what happened. I want to know what he does next.
Like to see, like, I hope they make, like, this is such a good subject to broach, like, a documentary on.
Oh, 100%.
I want to fucking see that.
Jeff Keighley does these kind of things. I can't remember what they're called. He used to do them for game trailers. I think he did one for Portal. Greg, do you know, by chance?
No, I do not, but I know what you're talking about.
He did, like, two or three of them now. Like, big documentaries on games. And I'm not sure what the title of the documentaries would be. They're the same title, but it's based on different things. I would love, since he's so close with Hideo Kojima, I want Jeff Keighley to freaking do a documentary on what the hell happened with this game and this relationship between Konami and Kojima.
I don't know if... I forget where I read it from, but the last I heard, he was trying to do one on the whole Amy Hennig Naughty Dog debacle, which would also be...
Oh, was he?
Yeah, that's what I read that somewhere. I
that have happened in this generation that I want to... see or hear everything about.
I want
Amy Hennig, Last Guardian, and
I want Metal Gear. I want the Hideo Kojima one more than anything else.
I do as well. It used to be Last Guardian for me, but it's definitely now it's the Hideo Kojima one.
Yeah, I
want to
know.
What sucks about it is that it doesn't really matter what happens. Konami is not going to be affected by this. Like, most of the chat doesn't rise, as we've brought up before, and I brought up the graph. Video game segment worldwide, not just the U.S., the video game segment worldwide for Konami accounts for less than 4% of their overall business. Yeah. That is nothing. I think it's actually less than that. I think it was 0.4. It was a very, very, very minute amount. So it doesn't really... It's not going to affect them nearly in the way that we would wish it would with all this. So it doesn't really matter. They don't really have
to care. At the same time, I do think they're scared.
It could be bad publicity,
Yeah, he's going to say a lot of things, I think. Or maybe not. Maybe he's going to be,
I feel like he's a more respectful person.
Yeah, exactly. Maybe he's going to be respectful and keep his mouth shut. But I hope that he doesn't. I want to hear every little detail. Let's get into the game premieres, because I don't want to fall too far behind. We got a lot of PSX stuff as well. So I'll play all the trailers. If we want to turn up the volume on them, we can. First up was Uncharted 4 Thief's End. We got the new character. I'm trying to think of her name. I think it's Naomi, right? She's a black character voiced by a white girl. We found out later on. There was a whole debacle that it's voiced by Laura Bailey.
It's still an issue for most people.
Well, now that Neil Druckmann kind of came out on it and talked about how the character was given to Laura Bailey before they even finalized the art design for that character. Now it's like, okay.
I'd still stick by what I posted. On whatever thread it was, comment thread. But it's not like, here's my problem with it. I agree with changing a role, to another nationality or whatever. That's a bad thing. You don't want to do that. But you can't, like, especially in voice acting, you can't sit there and say, well, what's this character supposed to be? Whatever we want. All right, is a man or woman? Woman. Is she black, white, Hispanic? Doesn't matter. Okay, well, you need to give it to a black woman. Why? Because I said so. Like, that doesn't... No, don't... Like, and I hate that. And that's what really struck me the wrong way. What I posted was, oh, wow, that's the greatest performance we ever heard. Unfortunately, you're white, and we can't give this to you. We need to give it to someone who wasn't as good as you.
Yeah, I think the whole thing, like, I get it. They want... Like, everybody wants, like, fair work. And the whole equal rights. I'm cool with it. I'm on board. But, like, everyone's getting a little fucking nuts. Like, we're just looking for reasons to fucking raise a cause for things. Like, just chill out.
That's kind of like people talk about social justice warriors. And it shouldn't be a bad thing, but it's got a derogatory kind of connotation to it now, because that's what it is. It's about people that take it too far.
Right.
It's like, this is too far. Like, right. Supposedly, Neil Druckmann came out and said, there's a white character in the game voiced by a black guy.
Right.
Like,
exactly, yeah.
It's just, we choose our voice actors before we finalize our character designs. Right. Like, character design is this fluctuating thing. We see that in games very often. Look at Infamous, for instance.
Yeah.
Like, you know, character designs change. Mm-hmm. They just decided, after, you know, halfway through development, once they already had Laura Bailey do the motion capture and the voice work, then they were like, you know what? It would be nice to have a little bit more diversity in this game when it comes to our characters. Let's make it a black character. And then once they had Laura Bailey's voice with that character, like, oh, it works great. Like, this fits the character so well and the visual that we've given to that character. So yeah, I think it's fine.
It's not good enough.
If I was a black woman, honestly, I would raise the point of, like, I'm sorry, how are black women supposed to sound? Why can't they sound white?
That was what was so weird. Like, I went on a topic, and somebody was like, the moment I heard that voice, like, I knew it was a white woman. I was like, what? Like,
yeah, like, what the fuck?
Why does that sound like a white woman? Like, right. I could have totally been a black woman. I wouldn't have known any better.
There are so many, like, anomalies in voice acting. Like, Tommy Pickles from The Rugrats was voiced by, like, a 40-year-old woman. And, like, Clementine from The Walking Dead is voiced by 35-year-old Melissa Hutchinson. Like, there, and Ashley Johnson as Ellie in The Last of Us. She was playing like a teenage girl, but she's in her.
It's not exactly the same as that.
I get what he's saying.
It's not exactly the same.
What it implies is that they need to sound like they're street. And you need to sound like you have a little bit of
that's,
like,
yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, that's implying that.
This isn't about a gender or age thing. It's about race.
Like, that's bullshit. I know plenty of black women who are, like, totally well-spoken.
Yeah.
It was funny.
You never know that you close your eyes, you don't know what the fuck.
Yeah, and if you're going to say that's a black woman that sounds like like talking white, like, no, like, don't. Right. That's not what you should be saying.
I really am curious, because it's happened more and more lately in the past couple of years than it ever did before. I really want to know the ratio of people of color that were offended by this, and people that are white that are afraid that they feel that they should have been offended by this.
Yeah,
I want to know the ratio of who actually said something.
I'll tell you, and I said this in the chat.
70-30.
When I saw this, the moment I saw Laura Bailey, I was like, shit.
Yeah.
I was like, I know what's coming. Like, I knew the moment I saw that name attached to the character, I was like, this is going to be a fucking shitstorm. Like, it's like, there's no way these things go past, like, the audience in gaming anymore without something happening.
But did you know that we had other trailers that we showed?
Far Cry Primal, but who cares? It was a game we already knew about.
Everybody else cared about it, though.
Wait,
I didn't.
Greg, what are you saying?
Can I say three? Oh, wait, no, we have another Uncharted piece coming, correct?
Yeah, we do.
Yeah, okay, just make
for PSX, so we'll get to that one. This was kind of a surprise moment, something more worth talking about. Psychonauts 2, coming out of nowhere.
Yeah, that was, well, no, because they did tease it.
I don't think so. I think this came out of nowhere.
No, they did tease that something last year, and I can't remember what it was, and we were all like, everybody was like, all right, cool, that's good. But it was kind of just like a tease of, like, this could be coming. It wasn't, like, anything official, but this is the first time we've actually seen, like, physical movement from characters.
Kind of a Kickstarter type thing, but they're using a new service called, I think, Fig, which I haven't heard of before. It's got a $3.3 million production budget. That's what they're trying to raise, which is pretty hefty. They're not holding back on this one. So, yeah, if you want Psychonauts 2 to happen, better get over to that Fig, whatever it is, the new one, and start donating.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Up after that, we had Quantum Break. We already knew about this game, of course, but Sean Ashmore came out on stage, showed off some new footage. Iceman. Yeah, that's how they kind of pushed it. Are you guys excited about
this? They announced him as Sean Iceman.
Yeah.
Actually, I was like, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Like, if you get to live by that for the rest of your life because you played Iceman, that's awesome.
Wait,
I'm confused. I didn't see this at all. What is the Quantum Break footage? Is this the Xbox One exclusive game?
This is the Xbox One exclusive from Remedy.
Greg didn't watch any conferences, by the way.
I didn't watch the whole conference at all. Why the hell was this at PSX?
It wasn't at PSX. This was at the Game Awards.
This is Game Awards, guys.
Oh, this is... Okay, just make sure.
Yeah, this is the Game Awards.
I'm still being cautious on it.
Okay.
Because we haven't seen... We saw some gameplay, but it was still kind of... Like, all right, this could work, but I could see where it could be repetitive and dull, especially after a short time. So I'm still kind of not sure what to feel about it.
They got a good track record, though, those guys at Remedy.
That's
so
episodic Quantum Break, right?
Not necessarily. No. It's there's a TV component to it.
Yeah, that's going to be... Yeah.
After that, here's the Rock Band VR stuff. This was Oculus. coming out on stage, Palmer Luckey.
About 5 minutes of things I didn't give a fuck about.
Yeah.
It didn't seem like it landed really with
no,
the
no one
at
cared
all.
At all.
Let's turn it up a little bit. I want to hear what they're saying, because I actually didn't watch this yet.
Is one of the most difficult songs out there, in the real world and in Rock Band.
So we hired them as consultants to teach us how to think, act, and feel like a
it
rock
was entertaining.
Star.
These guys needed a lot of work.
We're not sure if this would be even successful.
So yeah, I know that one, Through the Fires and the Flame, yeah.
Any questions?
I almost did this as
yes,
my
Papa.
Lip sync.
Okay, so this is supposed to be comical here?
Yeah, it's
dude,
just all good. Just like,
is that too early for groupies?
The game developer.
Yeah, there's some bits that are funny. Like, it was a funny skip.
Right, it was a funny skip, but like realistically, like it wasn't...
The actual product, no one really gives shit about.
Right, that's the problem, is that it was a lot of fun and entertainment for something I don't care about.
Yeah, a lot of fanfare for something that I really don't
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out, like, how does it work?
It makes you like you're in the crowd.
Okay.
So like while you're playing, you can see like
your okay, audience. Here we go. So you're looking around.
Yeah, you
yeah.
can see the audience.
It's kind of like the heart Guitar Hero Live then.
Although when you do it like that, it kind of looks like it looks like I Am Bread or something like that, where the thing's
yeah,
just like
it's
moving uncomfortably.
Yeah. All right. Good to see VR getting some support, though. That's what it's going to need if it's going to succeed. After that, Greg, you were really excited about this Shadow Complex Remastered coming to
yes!
PS4. Yeah. Kind of surprising.
No, listen.
I don't know anything about this game.
Shadow I know that it's
Complex.
Awesome.
Yeah, it's really good.
It's scrolling. It's very much Metroidvania style game. Nolan North voices the main character. It came out on Xbox, and it was the second game I bought on the Xbox Live Summer of Arcade. This game is so good. Like, oh my god, I'm so excited. And then when I read the article too and found out it was coming to PS4, it just makes me all the more happy. It was Xbox 360 exclusive for the longest time. And then it finally, and now it's coming to PC too, which is really cool. So other people get to experience this game. It is so, so good. Definitely check it out when it releases.
Yeah, I'll fucking play this. I'm so down for it.
Yeah,
it's
so good.
Yeah, the story and the voice work is apparently pretty darn good too.
It's phenomenal.
See if I got that right there. Yep, after this, Telltale doing Batman.
This was awesome.
Please, next one.
Are you serious?
No, I fucking was so sad.
You flipped shit, are you kidding me?
No, I mean, some people are really down on this news.
No
like, really
way.
Down.
Yeah, well,
so
Greg
excited.
Is, because he's a negative fucking Nancy.
I get his concern.
Yeah,
No. I am not down on playing a Telltale Batman game. I'm stoked. I'm going to play this. I'm going to pre-order it. It's totally a thing I'm playing. My concern is the fact that Telltale as a studio needs to either expand, they need to branch off and do something, or they need to finish their series or say definitively, we're not going to continue these series. They can't be leaving stuff up in the air because as a gamer for me, like there are stories now that I want to continue. Like I could give two shits about Minecraft as a game from Telltale, but like those people had that game. But now they have Game of Thrones. They have Back to the Future they just remastered. They're talking about doing another Back to the Future game. There's a rumor going around that they're going to try to do a Star Wars one. They have an unannounced Marvel property. Now they're doing Batman. They have Wolf Among Us, which we'll probably never get a second season of. Walking Dead Season 3 is now delayed because of this Michonne thing. Like there's so much going on. My concern is that they're taking on too much, and I just don't want to see these stories not get finished because most of them, if not all of them, end on a cliffhanger. Which
yeah.
Batman can be awesome, but if Batman ends on a cliffhanger and then we don't see a second season for 3 years or 4 years, but we get like a first season of every other property ever existing, like that annoys me personally.
At the same time, like I would be okay with them doing one season of some of these things.
Right,
it's, like, if it's just one season on Batman and it has closure and it's finished, I'm totally good with that.
Yeah.
Oh, 100%, but not if they leave it on a cliffhanger. Like, Wolf
yeah.
Among Us ends on a cliffhanger. Minecraft ends on a cliffhanger. Game of Thrones, cliffhanger. Walking Dead, every one of their series has ended on a cliffhanger.
I'm with you, first of all. Like, I understand what you're saying. I also am annoyed, like, that they're not more vocal about their plans, you know?
Yeah.
Like, if they would just say what they're doing. But just to play devil's advocate, for the sake of conversation, like, you watch TV shows without knowing that there's going to be a second season.
That's true, I guess. But
you know what I mean? Like,
how was Leftovers season one?
Like, you started watching The Walking Dead, and like, you didn't fucking know. Maybe they didn't.
There's always
didn't
a chance these shows get canceled, and it season. Sucks when it happens. But it happens often.
You get four seasons in and be like, "Holy shit, I need to know what happens." And you'll never see
Breaking it. Bad almost got canceled every season until like the fifth.
Yeah.
Like it was only like around season four or five that finally everybody realized this is the greatest show ever.
Right,
watch
yeah.
this.
So that's
like
downdraw, I would say, to the episodic.
Well, the one thing that gets me for that though is. Telltale has now made so much money, and obviously they're putting out more games. So I know that none of these series, it's not like a television show in the sense that like they don't have the funding or the ratings. Like they're obviously getting people to buy these games. So that can't
we need to stop making so many games and spend some of that money and fix that fucking engine. for sure.
Well, 100%. Yeah, that's what I mean, though, is like they have all this stuff. Like they're not going to come out and be like, guys, we had a Wolf Among Us season two. It's now canceled. Like it's not like a Fox show where like Gotham was like kind of up in the air for a bit. Like it's not like they could just cancel it halfway through. You know what I mean?
Batman.
Yeah, I mean, it's cool. It fits.
It's awesome.
It's a detective game.
I seriously
right?
lost my shit. I was sitting in my chair. I had a blanket on. I was, like, real comfy, and I was, like, just enjoying the show, and then, like, I saw the ink, and then I started hearing them talking about, like, we need to take this city back from them. I was like, what the fuck is going on here? And then the bat came up, and I was like, get the fuck out of here, dude.
You're like, flame on, and your quilt sets on fire.
I was so happy.
Dina, I know, was in it more. You were in it some, but like the G chat when
I was cleaning and everything. Like I was fixing the floor and do all this kind of stuff while the TGAs were on set.
But we were all like in the G, and it was really entertaining. We did a little bit for the PSX, although we were all at different times. But it was really entertaining. Like you, like simultaneously, like me, Dean, Puss, and Rick just all started freaking out in the chat.
It
like
was
all
so
the same.
That was cool. We missed two of them there. Rocket League is coming to Xbox One. Good for you guys on Xbox.
The Halo cars look pretty cool.
Yeah, definitely. And Gears of War cars too. And then Star Citizen we missed as well. It looks so beautiful from a graphical perspective. It looks really ambitious and big scale. A lot going on there. A lot of different gameplay variations going on in that one game. So that looks really cool. And now, as we were just talking about, another Telltale thing here. Two in one show. The Walking Dead, the game, Michonne. I was totally down on this. Like, cut the shit. Get back to Clementine, season 3. I don't give a shit about Michonne. Get the fuck out of here.
They need to stop restoring everything for, as much as they can.
And they ended on that, too, like, as if it was, like, this big deal. And for me, I was just like, I don't give two
exciting.
Shits about this.
This is very exciting for the comic book readers because there's a huge gap in the comic book storyline where Michonne just goes missing and they don't explain anything. So that's what this storyline is going to cover. It's covering 20 issues where she's just not involved in the story. Like,
but only three episodes. For Telltale.
But Robert Kirkman literally just wrote her out of the story, and then he even said, like, as he's continuing on the series, he's like, I forgot that she was one of my major players, and then he's like, I put her back in and wrapped her back up.
Gotcha.
So I'm excited that we finally can see what the hell she's doing.
Can we, real quick, talk about the tribute?
To Iwata, yeah.
It was, I love that they did that.
Mm-hmm.
I appreciate all of it. I fucking hate Reggie. He was so fucking business the entire time up on stage. It felt so impersonal.
It's kind of funny. There's certain people, though, that just have that voice.
I was going to say, I think that's just kind of... I think that's just him.
Another one for me, like, if you guys listen to, like, Blogcast on PlayStation, Sid Schumann, he's the main host of that.
Yep.
Every time I listened to him on that podcast, I was like, this guy I can't stand. Like, he's got to stop putting on this, like, really hardcore radio voice. And then I saw him outside of that, just, like, casual... That's just him. That's how he sounds. Like, that is his voice.
I know, it was just, like, the whole thing with him, when he was talking, he had the most time to talk about it. And, I guess I get it. But at the same time, it just all felt impersonal. It was, like, the way he spoke about, you know, Iwata was the same way they spoke about quarterly earnings at an E3 conference. You know, it was literally no... And I get you're saying that it's how he talks. But then don't have this guy give that...
The thing is, it was definitely a tribute to Iwata, but it was also, they talked about this on, I think, Kind of Funny, they talked about it on one of their Colin and Greg Live, and it was, Colin was totally right on it. He was talking about that there was definitely a message behind this, and it was, this was the Nintendo, you think we fuck up all the time, but we know what we're doing.
Right.
And Iwata was a big part of that. They were trying to kind of, I think, stick it a little bit to people as well, especially with NX on the horizon. They're trying to be like, you guys thought that the Wii, remember when we announced that name and everybody was like, this is bullshit, and like, now Wii is a household name. He's like, remember, you know, Nintendo DS with two screens, remember this, remember that, remember Nintendogs? Yeah, like, we were right, you were wrong. Like,
right.
It felt like they were really kind of in the same way of giving a tribute to Iwata, they were also sticking it to all those people that didn't have faith in them. They were saying...
What was this? Was this Kind of Funny something?
This Kind of Funny did Colin and Greg Live, and they talked about it.
Okay.
If you can watch out one of the archives, it was a really good discussion on the tribute. They thought it was great. They loved it. They loved how there was this message behind it. I get what you're saying, though. That's just Reggie.
The whole time I was watching I kept thinking, I was like, there is no good way to transition out of this back into, like, what this show is. And then, sure enough, the next thing they showed was like, doop, doop, doop. And I was like, oh my god, that's brutal, dude. There's no good way to do it. Like,
yeah.
There wasn't.
There isn't. All right, now we get to the meaty stuff, the more exciting stuff, I guess. Well, partially. PSX was... not as good as last year.
How about that awesome closer with Deadmau5, man?
With the Game Awards.
Holy shit, that was so bad.
Let's start.
I like Deadmau5 too, so and that was like, oh my god.
Let's get into PSX. First up, unbelievable footage of Uncharted 4. Let's put up the volume a little bit here. Put this on the big screen for a moment. The introduction of
not
Sam.
Not helping yet.
I was almost like, stop, guys, stop, stop. Like, you need to cut this because you're showing me too much right now. Right? Didn't you get that vibe as well?
A little bit, yeah.
I was like, this is way too long. Like,
I feel like this is the intro. This is the first time you see how they're coming.
I was saying, this is like the first of all I remember that Troy Baker taking where like he's like transcending his own, like, because normally in a game you're like, oh, there's Troy Baker. But like, he sounds like he's playing this guy.
Yeah.
It sounds good.
This game is taking it so much further than The Last of Us and Uncharted, where it, like, this is more like a movie than anything I've ever seen. Like, the direction, the facial animation, the character animation, everything about it is just so, like, above and beyond what we're seeing in other games. It's like Naughty Dog is just, as always, set it,
killing
a precedent. Yeah, they're killing it. They really are. And fast forward a little bit here, I'll put it back down to the small screen. There was one kind of surprise moment in this when they're sitting on the bench, kind of came out of nowhere. Let me kind of fast forward.
It's cool, but I feel like it's blown out of proportion.
It's just interesting. There it is. We have dialogue choices in this. We don't know how far it goes, but we've never had that in Uncharted before.
Yeah, can I be honest with you?
We think it's going to be used sparingly.
Yeah.
Yeah, but and I get it, and it's cool because it's different. It's never been had before, but to me, it's a, guys, we have side quests type moment
maybe
for me. You know what I mean? Where, like, no. I'm talking about, like, the Nintendo Zelda thing.
Oh, okay.
You know, to me, it's just like, guys, we have side quests, and your horse dodges trees. Like, that's all that was to me.
See, I think you're underestimating Naughty Dog here.
Yeah, here's the thing. That could imply that you have a choice in this game.
Yeah.
You might have multiple endings here. We don't know.
Yeah. I think you're underestimating. Naughty Dog, when they do something, they do it. Like,
right,
they go for it.
Like,
Greg, what are you going to say?
More.
I have three things to say about this. I played the Uncharted 4 beta, and I've played it every day since its release. The Uncharted, speaking graphically about the game, holy mother of God. And that's not even the cinematics parts, which are phenomenal, but, like, the 60 frames per second, like, multiplayer, the graphics, there's not one bit of lag. It's absolutely phenomenal. That being said, number two I have to say about it, The Last of Us multiplayer is kind of merging its way into the Uncharted multiplayer, and the multiplayer itself isn't that great. So for people that were, like, really intrigued, like, I was overhyping the multiplayer, it's not like Uncharted 2 and Uncharted 3. They tried to bring in some of the elements of The Last of Us multiplayer, and they're two totally different games. So I'm hoping they don't do that with the story.
Yeah, that's exactly.
Wait, are you saying that you don't like it, or are you just saying that it's different?
I don't like it, personally.
Okay.
I'm not a fan of the Uncharted 4 multiplayer because my concern is that they're hopefully not going to put the same gameplay elements from multiplayer into the single player because it's very much the guys that did Last of Us, and you could totally tell. Like, there's now your teammates now, instead of just dying and respawning like a Call of Duty multiplayer, like, your teammates fall down, you can revive them, but it doesn't work because it's so fast-paced. It's very odd. My third comment on this whole thing, I'm so mad because Elena is always a fucking afterthought in this series.
Intentionally so, dude. He did that on purpose. That was totally setting up the Elena versus trophy hunting in this game, and I loved it. I loved that Elena wasn't an afterthought in that conversation.
How was she an afterthought?
Because he's like, oh, Elena,
I'm married. I'm married.
Oh, yeah, but I don't think I didn't take that as, like,
I think this game ends with him not being with Elena.
He literally goes, the dialogue choices come up, and Sam goes, what's the most exciting thing that has happened to you since I've been to prison? What would be your first thought in your head if you hadn't seen your sibling in how long? I'd be like, oh my God, I have a wife, dude. This happened. Like, I
no,
like,
I'm sorry, no. Everybody gets married. Not everybody hangs off a cliff, off a mountain, off a train.
There's two sides to this. I agree with Dean because, first of all, Sam is also a treasure hunter, so that's the kind of stuff that they share.
Right.
But at the same time, I think that this was definitely intentional. And in my opinion, watching this, and Greg, you're going to hate it, I don't think Drake ends with Elena. Just based off this video alone, I think the game ends with a twist where he either loses Elena because she can't deal with it anymore. He chooses not to be with Elena. I think he goes with treasure hunting over Elena at the end of
the
game.
But can't we just discuss that Elena's the only reason why he even found El Dorado? Drake in the very first game was quitting. He was done. He was out of it. Elena's the only thing that got him to come back, and that's why they fell in love. That's what pisses me off so much about the Uncharted series, is because they set her up in the original game to be the person that kind of makes him go off the edge and kind of teeter off.
Yeah, you're right.
And he wouldn't have done anything in the whole end of the first game from chapter 10 on was all because of Elena. To go back and get Sully, Drake was like, fuck Sully, I fucking hate him. Elena's like, no, like, you have to listen. It's Sully, like, he's your best friend. And she's like, all right, okay. Then she's like, El Dorado, this is so exciting. What if you find him? He's like, all right, okay. And then he's talking to his brother, and he's like, Elena, who the fuck is that?
I do think you're a little too invested in the Elena thing. You're letting it affect your enjoyment of the game. When this is the story that they're trying to tell, intentionally so.
I don't like it, and I'm very upset.
Greg, life sucks.
I don't know.
Life is strange, but it's not that strange.
I think she's an afterthought because, like, it's about Drake, dude. It's not about Elena. That's why I think it's okay she's an afterthought. It's not the story of Elena.
I don't know.
She's a supporting character in the leading man's story.
Mm-hmm. All right, we're going to fall too far behind if we keep going. Real quick, before getting into the Final Fantasy VII remake, which is probably going to occupy a little bit of time, Sean Layden coming out on stage wearing a Crash Bandicoot t-shirt.
Yeah.
I feel like there's... I mean, I get why. And yeah. I want them to so bad.
I understand it's about legacy, but dude...
But
no,
that was,
you don't do that unless you're bringing Crash Bandicoot.
That's
back.
Kind of like, and I mean, you gotta remember too. Last year, it was, hey, you guys really like Final Fantasy VII, right? We got something for you.
Yeah,
you know, and so that's
port
of
the PC.
The only reason why I'm thinking maybe E3 could mean something. But other than that, I'm going to sign on the air of caution of we all love Crash. Who the fuck doesn't?
Yeah,
I like this shirt.
I agree.
You know what I mean,
I'm not gonna get my hopes up, but I think it was kind of dick.
There's a chance this is the closest chance we've gotten to a Crash remake of some sort.
Okay.
That's it. That's all I'm going to say.
Greg, what do you think? Crash coming back?
Should it come back? I don't think so. I say leave that with nostalgia. Just because I don't think that's a thing that should come back. Like, they're already doing Ratchet and Clank. They already did it with Sly. I think leave Crash, especially because it's not Naughty Dog doing it. And I'm
okay with them leaving it alone, but don't tease me.
Yeah,
don't tease me.
Yeah, I respect that. I respect that point of view because sometimes you look through rose-tinted glasses at certain things.
Yeah.
You know?
Retweet.
All right, and now into the biggest, one of the biggest moments, one of the two big moments. I'm going to put this up on the big screen. We'll listen to the volume on it because this is Final Fantasy VII Remake.
Soldier along. No way he'd throw all that away for us. What's his name anyway?
Got big Jesse Wedge.
And he says it's
right off the bat. Awesome.
Look. Heavy securing like this, you want a professional.
Red 13. Yeah. Now, this is clearly the opening of the game. This is the very opening, Sector 7 blow up, Avalanche. That's the exact opening. Like, Jesse kicking the guy.
You best be worth it.
Love me.
There's the Scorpion, Mecha Scorpion. He does, yeah. And I love it. We got some very 15 versus 13 stuff going on here. Almost like they're using the exact animations. Running them out Midgar there. This is the scene. We're directly from the original. Surrounded by the Shinra soldiers, but then jumping onto the train to escape. All this, like directly from the original.
You're doing this for the planet. Same as us.
Not interested.
Wait.
And now we got gameplay. This is where it gets crazy. Some people are for this, some people are against it. I'm for it. Kind of Kingdom Hearts-esque. You still have the command bar on the bottom left. You still have attacks magic. You control Barret. You have character switching, so that's still there. You saw two limit breaks there. You saw Braver. You saw Big Shots. And you can also see in the bottom right that there's kind of like a combo thing going on. There's him jumping onto the train, as I was saying, directly taken from the original. And also here, directly from the original. But looks so damn good. And then this final shot here of Cloud, they nailed it. Spin flip, directly from the original. He's got that thin, gaunt look, as he should. Awesome. I was ecstatic. Exactly what I wanted from this, right? And then, today, shoot you motherfuckers! Crash into a fucking wall!
Oh my god.
I wish I could get as excited as you and Greg do about certain things.
I'm so upset.
Oh, I am pretty excited about
this. This is how I feel about Elena, just saying.
It depends on
what. No, here's the thing. I'm trying to remain optimistic, but just an hour ago, or 2 hours ago now, IGN, first report, they're planning on this being a multi-part series, episodic Final Fantasy VII.
See,
here's
so
the thing.
Drew, I read this originally as like Final Fantasy 13, 13, 2, and so on. Is that not what
that's they that's like the thing here? Is that what we don't know? We need to have a clear answer here. Because does this mean that we're going to get like Before Crisis and Surge of Derb, Dirge of Cerberus? Sorry, Surge of Derberus. Are we going to get Advent Children in Game 4? What does it mean exactly? What does it mean exactly? But here's the thing: if it means that we're splitting up the game into Midgar or first disc, second disc, third disc, if that's what it means, they better not compromise the overworld, the world map, all that kind of stuff. I better not, like, have episode 1 end with Midgar, which is fine if it ends there with getting out of Midgar, and then at episode 2 start with you not going out onto an open world. If it starts with me immediately being in calm and them just going from set piece to set piece, I'm gonna be pissed. I'm gonna be so freaking pissed if they hyped us up on this game as being a remake and they're gonna completely cut out all this massive stuff and be like, oh, it's episodic, we're just taking set pieces and doing it that way. Mm-hmm. Like, if this is, oh, we get the game earlier now because we get episode 1 next year, and it's, if you put all episodes together, it's exactly as if it was a full game, no problem. I'm okay with that.
What would you do if it was episodic of only the story, but when you get the game, you know, in all the pieces, however many they are, like, that is when it's all. Dude, that I want that.
Surge of Derberus.
Surge of Derberus. That was amazing. What would you do if, like, what would be your thought process of it's, you know, up to Midgar, up to, you know, second disc, but it's only the story parts, but then after everything is, you know, said and done, they have a patch it.
No! No! It. No!
Right, but. That is the most likely.
I know. If they're doing episodic, I better get, like, this is the thing they got to do. This is what makes it weird, is if, like, side quests and backtracking and stuff that's all in the original, where I can go back to towns I was in the beginning parts of the game using airship, using world map, I better still be able to do that. And if that means episode 2, 3 have to be the exact same size as the first game with, like, 20 gigs per episode, I don't give a shit. Give me, like, I better get everything in every episode where I can go back to the original towns and all that side quest stuff is still there. They better not compromise on that stuff.
You're not gonna be happy.
That's what I'm talking about. I'm not happy about this. This is ruining what was everybody was so hyped about. We want a remake. Like, it's okay if you mess with the combat system a little bit. I get it. Like, turn-based doesn't make a ton of sense anymore. They're keeping a lot of what made the combat system great, though. Like, you can still see, you're still attacking, still got magic, still got summons, even have a defend button, like, which means there has to be some kind of turn-based nature there. So that's cool. Like, I like what they're doing. They're making more action-based. But do not change the structure of this game from a story perspective and what made this, the first one so great. The side quests, the world, the atmosphere. Like, do not change that. That's not okay.
Do you want to open a lineup for Strife Girl?
And Strife Girl, I really want to hear from you. Joe is another huge Final Fantasy VII fan, though. So we'll start with Joe. All right, Joe, what's your 2 cents on this, man?
Final Fantasy VII Remake? Oh, man. Man, I honestly don't know. But when I saw the gameplay, it went crazy. There were some things I saw that I was, I'll be honest with you, I was nitpicking. I'm still glad, like, because when I saw the gorgeous stuff, I was like, oh my god, I couldn't believe this. Oh my god, it looks so freaking beautiful. Oh my god, Midgar looks exactly the same as it does. Oh my god, their voices, like, Wedges and everyone's voices sound exactly how I thought they sound and everything, you know? But then I started noticing the stuff I didn't like, for instance. Okay, can we just talk about this for a second? Why the fuck does Barret look like Blade?
Dude, I
the only thing that makes him look like Blade is the glasses. He looks just like he looks in the original, in my opinion, but he has sunglasses now. Yeah, so everybody's like, oh, he looks like Blade.
I don't know, dude. He has the same, like, I mean, maybe to some extent, but, like, the outfit is the same, the way he walks.
Well, his outfit is directly from the original, which I'm happy about. The only thing they changed was adding the sunglasses. It does give him a Blade look. I don't have a problem with that. I think he looks pretty badass, personally.
I mean, imagine being able to play as Blade in Final Fantasy. That would be crazy.
He's a badass character, and he looks badass. Like, I think that's cool. And I also like that they're keeping his anger and his kind of, like, cocky, badass attitude, but he's not jumping up and down, smashing his fists, and, like, beating his chest.
Oh, I kind of,
like,
wish he did that.
He's just, he's more realistic, but also, I like him. It's a good evolution of that character. It makes sense for next gen and for modern times.
Yeah, I'm not saying that. But now, another thing that came up in my mind is, are they going to call her Aeris or Aerith? I honestly don't know.
It's a tough question. In Kingdom Hearts, I think they called her Aerith. So that makes me think they're going to go with Aerith.
Where the whole confusion
comes from? I like Aerith more. I kind of like it better. Aerith sounded weird to me.
See, I like Aerith more personally, but that's because like I grew up with Aerith. The American version was Aerith. The Japanese version was Aerith.
Okay, because on the port, the PC port, yeah. It's Aerith.
So yeah, there's a good sign of what's to come. It'll probably be Aerith.
Yeah, and another thing, are they going to go with DLC like they did in all the past ones? Because in 13, 13.2 and 13, I don't know if they did this in Lightning Returns. I don't know because I never played. Yeah, actually, no, yeah, they did. They did. They did do DLC for that. But are they going to do DLC for this? Like, not like, you know, stupid microtransactions. I'm talking about, like, you know, vanity items, maybe, like, an old, like, maybe Zack Fair's Buster Sword. Because if Zack Fair's in here, I swear, he's going to be in here. And he's my favorite.
No, he's going to be in the game. He has to be. That's a huge part of the story. I don't think there will be DLC in what you're talking about. They might have micro DLC, like you said, swords and costumes and stuff. But, like, story DLC and stuff, no. The more likely thing that we're hearing is that it's episodic. If you want to call that DLC, then I guess, but...
I don't want it to be upset. That's kind of stupid. Like you said, yeah. If they take away from like if they go like transition to like a different town or anything, I don't want them to do that.
I need the travel. Like that's what makes it feel like a journey.
You know, I want to go to the farm and, you know, like get a chocobo. I want to go to the, you know, the gold saucer.
Thing is, like, we've dreamt about this for so long. And when I dream about Final Fantasy VII, I've always dreamt about leaving Midgar for the first time in next gen. Seeing real-time weather and sunsets. And all I imagine every single time is getting past the valley. If you're getting out of Midgar, sunsetting, seeing the chocobo footprints on the ground, seeing calm in the distance, seeing the chocobo farm to your right, and then chocobos run past you with the overworld map. That is the dream. Like, that is what we all imagine. And if we don't get that because this is fucking episodic, I'm gonna be pissed.
Same here. But, you know, I trust Square Enix. I know they've messed up in the past and they've done a lot of wrongdoings and stuff. But you know what? They know that they can't fuck this up. And if they do, no one's ever gonna buy a game from them again because a lot of people have been wanting this for, what is it, about like, oh my God, like 15 years, something like that? Shit, more. And if they fuck this up, they're screwed. So pretty much, right. I'm not playing again.
I feel bad a little bit. These guys over here, like, I have no idea what's going on right now. But still, I'm glad to get your two cents, Joe. We're gonna take one more call from Mel because she's a huge diehard 7 fan as well. Thanks for calling in, man. Joe, thanks for calling in.
Yeah.
All right. See you later, man. Level up.
Level up.
He's over here shopping.
So
what's the difference between the blackout Yeti microphone and the regular one?
Call her, that's it. Just call her. You keep shopping because Mel's gonna call in now.
Up,
Mel, call in. I need to talk to you about this. We need to air this out. We need to get this out in the open. Here she is. All right.
I'm excited to hear from Mel.
Mel, talk to me.
I guess I'm laughing, sorry.
It's okay, no, there's a lot of emotion.
Yeah.
So what was your gut reaction when you saw me post that link?
There's boredom.
I'm not talking to you, Dean. I'm not talking to you, I'm talking to Mel right now. Mel, what was your gut reaction when I posted that link about episodic content?
Oh, well, to be honest, I don't know how to feel about these news, to be honest. I was talking about this a while ago with Tobes. On the chat, and in one hand, it could be a good thing, but in the other hand, it could be bad, and I mean really bad. Like, it could backfire.
It could ruin the game, potentially. It really could.
I mean, I understand that maybe the game is too long, but I would hate to have multiple episodes for each town or event. You can't do that in this game.
No.
You go.
It's got to be cohesive.
You go back and forth, town to town, do stuff, side quests, fight the weapons, and if they do that, they're going to mess up.
No, 100% agree. That's my main worry is. I agree with you on the positives, though. Like, it's really exciting to think maybe we get episode 1 next year, early 2017, as opposed to 3 years from now. That's really cool to think about. Like, if they can nail the episodic feel and keep the price right, like, if it's 3 episodes long and each episode is $20 and it feels like a cohesive game in the end, I'm good. No problem at all. Means I get to play it earlier. That's awesome. But there's a lot of ways this can go wrong.
I'm telling you right now, judging from what they said originally, where he's like, we could not do this, we don't have the resources to do it in the way that everybody wants it to, then going off of, oh, it's not going to be exactly what everybody's thinking, there's going to be things that change, and they weren't only referring to the combat.
No.
I'm going to say that right now. This, I'm telling you right now, it's going to be, these are the key moments that everybody wanted to see, and this is what we're playing. You might get that view that you wanted, but you're not going to be able to go around and, you know, just run around in circles in a giant valley for however long you want
to. Stop.
Like, it's
stop.
Just not going to happen.
Stop. Don't talk to me, criminal! Don't talk to me!
Here's the thing, I'm not trying, and what sucks is I know it sounds negative, but, like, I'm telling it from an outsider's perspective, it's just not going to happen, like, the way you want it. If it's episodic, it will not work in the way that you want it.
Yeah, I want to go that far. There is a way for it to work episodically. I'm worried about them doing it for the wrong reasons. If they're doing it because they want more money, if they're going to charge like $30 an episode and it's like four episodes long, like that sucks. Yeah. That
I got
sucks.
Something to say. Something real to say.
Go ahead.
Why? Why would they fuck with this?
I have no idea.
Like, everyone waited so long and now they got it and they're like, sweet, everyone's so happy. Then they're like, wait a minute.
No, I'm 100%.
Like,
no.
Why would you do that?
It's crazy.
Why would you ever do that?
I wasn't lying when everybody was choo-choo motherfucker. Like, everybody was on the hype train.
It was such a
almost
bad mood.
Everybody was positive about this footage. Some people were a little iffy on the combat because they wanted to be turn-based. But everybody, for the most part, was really, really positive about this.
Yeah.
And then when this posted, I sent the link of NeoGAF's topic to Square Enix, all their different ones. And I was like, Square Enix, look at this. Read it. I've got one word for you. Calibrate. Because look at this topic. Everybody is ready to burn the world down. Like, nobody is happy about this. Not one person is happy about this. Sorry, Mel, what were you going to say?
No, I was just going to say that maybe this is the changes that we're talking about a few months ago. Remember that?
The changes of the gameplay and stuff, yeah.
Uh-huh. I'm not sure if it was just the battle system that we're going to change, but I think they weren't over it with this episodic thing. And I don't know. I'm trying to not to...
I'm just hoping that, like, this episodic thing is just, like, a mistranslation entirely, to be honest with you, and it's just that we're gonna have Final Fantasy VII proper, and then you might get, like, Dirge of Cerberus, or Surge of Derberus, whatever you want to call it. You might get Advent Children, you might get Before Crisis. Maybe they're doing this as, like, a true multi-part series, where they're taking all of that Final Fantasy VII content and delivering it over time. My main hope is that this is a cohesive experience. If it's cohesive, I'm okay.
Yo, Mel, what do you got to say about that?
sorry.
No, you're good.
Drew, what do you think about the hate that the remake's getting right now?
I it's disappointing because everybody was so hyped. It's disappointing to see it go from such a high to such a low in literally a day. It happens so quickly.
Corran Horn, hey, is this the counseling meeting for Final Fantasy VII news?
Yes, we're all here to share, guys. My name is Andrew. I love Final Fantasy VII, and I'm ready to shit down Square Enix's throat. Like, I'm really upset about this. Surge or Derberus, guys. Or Dirge of Cerberus. All right, Mel, I'm sorry. We do have to move on. We do have a little bit more to talk about, but
okay,
yeah.
Okay.
I'm sorry. It's good to talk to you, Mel. Level up.
Level up.
I love you, Mel. Thank you for being so nice.
She's awesome. All right. That's it. Okay. We got to fly now. Let's fly. Next up. All right. COD Awaken Pack. I'm just going to skip through some of the boring stuff here.
No, just skip it completely.
That wasn't boring! Final Fantasy VII is what everybody wanted to talk about. Surge of Derberus, Dean. Surge
right.
of Derberus.
You can't keep like just correcting. Funny. You didn't say funny. Surge of Derberus. You said Surge of Derber.
Derber.
You're totally right. Everybody probably did. We're talking about Final Fantasy, but It was just so funny that right after that, you're like, I'm gonna skip through this, I was bored.
Fang announces a new character for Street Fighter.
That's pretty cool.
Looks cool. He looks
it's
like
Fang,
the,
by the way. It's not Fang. Everybody says Fang.
Everybody's flipping it back
no,
and forth.
No, but they introduced him verbally as Fang.
Okay. He looks like the character from Kung Fu Hustle.
I love it. Yeah. He looks so entertaining.
Yeah. He looks cool. After that, we have the Adult Swim games. There's six of them.
That's awesome. So this is a part of the game of the conference where it really started to focus on Vita, it seemed like.
Yeah,
all the, all these games right here, and then a bunch of the other ones coming. I think we have, what was it, like 9 Vita games?
There's a lot.
For Adult Swim, you have Death Gambit, you have Duck Game, Rain World, Raise the Dead, Small Radios, Big Television, and Double Fines.
Right.
Headlander.
All these games are Vita games.
Awesome. Yeah.
The first one is very Castlevania feeling.
Yeah, look cool.
And then the other one,
got the zombie one there, Raise the Dead, or Duck Game there.
Duck Game is weird. The next one, what was the other one? Rain World. Rain World is kind of like Ori meets Limbo. Is okay. Kind of what it looks like. And it has me and Rick.
There's
really
a lot of shit.
Jordan
Gio was saying, and he was like, and it's available on Vita, and he had such a big spawn of this. I was like, I don't know if he's fucking with this or not. And then I was like, oh, she's serious. Like, yeah. All these games are coming to Vita.
Yeah, it's almost like you wonder if it's sarcastic at this point. It's like, and it's available on Vita, guys.
I'm not going to lie. I want his fucking jersey, the third party production jersey.
Yeah, that was cool.
I like that. I want that.
Greg, I feel like you were about to say something. I saw your lips move. Oh, that's why.
Yay!
You're muted. Greg! You're muted. You're muted again. We can't hear you.
I can actually hear him.
Oh, you can?
It's muffled.
Oh, no, you're hearing the video. I have the video down real low. Greg, I will restart you here. Hold on one sec. This keeps happening, and I don't know when he leaves, so I feel like we're missing stuff from Gregory.
We are. We haven't heard almost anything from him tonight.
I wonder if your drivers are, like, updated, man.
Hold on, Greg. Hold on.
Get the new surgery.
Greg, can you hear us?
Hello.
There you go, you're back.
I wasn't going to say anything specifically on these events. Megan Grow, that came to the chat room, said, if you try to say unique New York really fast, it's really hard to say, so I sent it to myself and I started laughing.
I think Dirge of Cerberus is hard to say.
Dude, can we, if you guys follow us on Twitter, please hashtag Surge of Derber.
Surge of Derber. I tried to correct myself mid-sentence and it just didn't work. All right, David Tentacle just shown there, finally gets a release date. Psychonauts, getting a little VR exclusive story.
Yeah,
That's pretty cool that it's getting some support, you know, here and there. You get to see, I can't think of his main character name here, but putting on the VR glasses. What was it called again? It's called The Rhombus of Ruin. So that's kind of cool. Dual Star of the Gever coming to PS4.
Which is great. So we were talking about this, and I'm kind of nervous about it because I don't know if it's going to be a full-fledged. They were pitching it as a full-fledged game.
Yeah.
Which scares me that it's going to be a $20 title. But because you own the original, is it going to, like, am I going to have to buy this for $20 and have two versions of Don't Starve on my system?
I hope not.
Or am I going to be able to upgrade for like $5, $8, $10, however much it is? Mm-hmm. If we do, I definitely want to do a dual stream.
Oh, 100%.
On a Thursday.
You know, I'm not a big co-op fan. This is a game I would totally co-op. I really,
really
like Don't Starve.
Rick, he's like, oh my God, yes, it needs to happen.
Greg, I feel like you played Don't Starve too, didn't you?
A little bit, and then I cried a lot because everything I did just didn't work out.
It's brutal when you have to start over.
I was saying, Rick,
you were playing a lot when I first started getting to know it. When I first started coming around, you were playing
he has easily one of the best game streams we've ever done. And he spent so much time making this fortress, and he, like, at first it was like, really, you don't know what you're doing, and he finally figured out how to do it. He kept going in, and he's like day like 60 or something like that, or 50 or something, and he created this wall of like crop and everything like that, so everything he needs is around him, and he has these plants, and apparently one of the plants evolved, and Greg's already laughing because he knows what's coming.
Yeah, let me explain here. I need to explain. All right, so you have different materials you can use to create walls. I, for some reason, chose to make my walls out of hay and wood, as opposed to stone. It's kind of like the Three Little Pigs, right? Because so, you need more resources to do, like, the stone walls. It's more difficult. So you get there, right? You're gradually, like, I had a whole wall of hay. Then behind that, I had a whole wall of wood. And I was going to do the stone wall eventually, right? I was getting there. And outside my walls, I used this really cool plant that would fend off wolves when they come to attack you. And I thought I was golden.
It would, like, bite at them.
I thought I was, like, set for years in this game. I was like, there's no way I'm going to survive the winter. I'm good to go, right? The wolves come. It's the wolves that evolved. I didn't realize.
Oh, okay.
So my plants are there. I'm like, fuck you, wolves. Like, you got nothing on me. Plants are destroying them. Didn't realize that the wolves evolved to when they die, they explode in the fire. So they die close enough to my walls that the entire base, the hay, the sticks, everything just blows up in flames. And I just start crying.
Like, he's just like, no, no. Like, he's freaking out so hard.
All gone in seconds. Like, in flames.
Oh my God.
The best part was Drew's little character, because in the game, he kind of just like bops around. Like, he looks all happy like. And the little character's bopping around, and it's going through Drew's entire fortress that he just built. Drew just like, tears. He's just like, why?
I'm running in circles, trying to recreate things while the wolves are chasing me.
The wolves are still chasing him, too. So he's trying to survive now with wolves chasing him. And then, even funnier, he goes to like a fire pit area and he needs to like eat in order to stay alive. And he's like trying to eat.
But you gotta cook your food. So I'm like trying to cook while the wolf is running around the fire. And I'm like, wait
for a second. And then runs away.
I'm going in circles.
Like, dude, it went on for so long. And it was
put the Benny Hill music to it and it would have been perfect.
Oh my God, it was amazing.
It was bad. All right, so we missed a few things there. Yakuza 5 coming December 8th. Yakuza 0 also being announced for PS4.
Mind
that's
you,
good.
In the G chat, this is where Dean goes, guys, this is getting, I mean, does it get any better? This is getting kind of boring to me. I wanted to make sure that was known. This is, right now, is where he's at. Okay, keep going.
Okay. King of Fighters 14 console exclusive. That's pretty cool for those fans that it's coming only to PS4. Another one, kind of big deal, but not for me personally. Team Ninja, you know, Ninja Gaiden, they're making a new game called Neo exclusive to PS4.
Remind me a lot of Onimusha.
Yeah, it looks like Onimusha and Ninja Gaiden. Yeah. It definitely has that vibe going there, so that's cool for those fans. Bastion, finally, on Vita now, that's and it's only $2.99.
Yeah. Yes.
And if you bought it on PS4, it's cross-buy. You downloaded it this morning.
Oh, yeah. It's cross-buy.
Yep.
Yeah.
Nice.
Good game. Play it if you haven't.
Here's Neo on the screen right now. You can totally see the remnants of Ninja Gaiden Onimusha in this game here. It looks really cool.
And now at this point, Dean's going, are we going to get anything that I really care about? I mean, I already have Bastion. If I can play it again for free, that's great. But I want some new fun games.
This I liked a little bit. Yeah.
Are we talking about Brutal?
Huh?
Brutal was what's up next. It was just on screen there. Did you guys like that at all?
I liked it a little bit.
It's
this was kind of cool. The direction that they went in.
It kind of reminds me of Mad World in a little bit of a way.
Okay,
you remember that on Wii?
Yeah, the weird color. They used the colors of the world. It's pretty interesting.
Well, yeah.
That's the direction I got from it more than
it definitely has a little bit of a Tron vibe as well.
Yeah.
Exclusive to PS4, I'm pretty sure as well. That one there. It's Stormcloud's first game. They're a new studio with.
What's it called?
It's called Brutal,
yeah,
with a at sign as the A instead. Clever. After that, we had two games available right now when they announced them. Guns Up and Fat Princess Adventures.
Right. Now, Fat Princess Adventures and Guns Up are both discounted for PS Plus users. Fat Princess Adventures is kind of more Diablo-esque than the original Fat Princess was.
Let's turn up the volume on this next one here. Because, man, does this game look good.
Dude, oh my God.
Yeah,
I said, like, immediately, I was like, this is the best CGI I've ever seen.
It's not CGI, it's real, it's in-game. It's freaking insane. So let's put it up on the
right
big screen.
This in-game?
This is their in-game engine. Yeah, the cutscenes obviously look a little better than the...
I'm saying, just, this is
I'll
the
never
best
be a ranger.
Graphic visual I've seen.
Yeah. It looks like, I thought for a second, I was like, is this the movie or is this the game?
I thought that too.
Right?
I thought they were showing the movie for a little bit.
Yeah. And also, it's really cool coming from us who have played Ratchet and Clank to see this scene recreated, you know, from the original, and a much better way.
It kind of worries me.
To the game?
Not the cinematic, the gameplay.
Oh, okay.
You've already seen like super long footage from the game.
Where
everyone's like, yeah,
it's bundled. 5.
Like, I almost wonder if, like, they're using cutscenes from the movie in the game.
I don't know, yeah.
Like, because this looks... is it even possible to look this good? Like, it looks so damn good.
I did think it was super stupid and hilarious that... Who presented this?
This was Ted Price.
Ted Price. He was like... He's talking about the movie, and then he's like... They are in danger. But if you have a PlayStation 4, you get to play the game with such and such time. I was like, well...
been in a crash.
You only get to play the game if you have a PlayStation 4.
Yeah,
right.
So why the fuck would you say that?
Yeah, it was kind of a weird thing to say. I agree. It also was weird that he didn't announce that it's $39.99, because that's huge news.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah, it's only $39.99. That's amazing.
All right, well, now, goddamn.
Yeah, like, that's really, really big news.
But it's April, right?
It's coming out in April before the movie now. They pushed it up in front of the movie, and that makes perfect sense to get it right there, coincide with the game. So, yeah, this introduction of the two characters together here, I thought it was really, really well done. And then I thought the gameplay looked great, personally.
Yeah, yeah, it just worries me because the first game in comparison to the latter games is very slow.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's not slow all the time. I get that. I get that it picks up. But in comparison to the other games gave you more to do, gave you more chaos, gave you more destruction. Right, I just hope they
let's go back to, let's go to Greg real quick on that one. Ratchet, because I know you haven't played the series before. Did that excite you, Greg, seeing the Ratchet video?
Yeah, I'm checking out the game. Like you said, it's $40, so I'm definitely going to buy it no matter what when it comes out. It'll be an indie game. It's going to be my first, like I said, Ratchet and Clank game. It's not like a game that I look at and I'm like, oh my god, I need to play this game. But it looks like it's fun. It looks like
I don't know why, man. I feel like you're really underselling it for yourself.
And you guys overhype everything. So like, usually I can tell if I'm gonna really, really love something or not. I'm not sure if I'm gonna fall in love with this game as much.
You know, keep yourself in that camp, because when you play the game, I feel like you'll enjoy it even more now, knowing that your expectations are lowered. Now we get into the VR portion of the show.
As soon as they came out on stage for this, I was watching the conference later, and I watched, and I was probably about 10 minutes ahead of Dean, and he goes, and he's like saying how bored he is and anything like that, and then you just see him laugh hysterically and go, this guy just asked me if we're ready to get virtual, or something, or...
that's what he said.
Right, yeah, he's like...
He
he's
said
like,
those this... words. He said, are you guys ready to get virtual? And I was like, fuck you.
Dude, like, he was in such a bad mood, he wanted to go to sleep, and I knew exactly how he said it. He was like, this guy has no idea who he's talking to right now. Like,
that's like a 1990s flashback right there.
Dude, I just had from work and I woke up at 5 and I was like so excited to watch this conference, and at this point I'm like, I'm so disappointed, and then he fucking said that sentence and I was like, I'm gonna go there and kill him. I'm going to kill him.
We got a few things that I actually am looking forward to. Eagle Flight looks pretty. I don't know what it is exactly. Yeah. It kind of looks like a non-game in a way.
Yeah.
Res Infinite, it's cool for Res fans that it's coming over to VR. Makes sense. Modern Zombies, the taxi thing.
I don't care.
For that to be Sony Santa Monica, I was just like, come on. Like, what the hell is this? This is what Sony Santa Monica brought to the table for PlayStation Experience? Like, come on. Golem, or Gollum, however you want to say it. That was the most exciting to me.
Yeah.
That
was the charming one, right?
Maybe. I don't know if that was a charming one, but it looks like a girl like in her bedroom wearing virtual reality glasses, but putting herself into this world as a golem. I just thought it looked visually really cool. I like the atmosphere, the vibe that it was giving off. I thought it looked pretty awesome, personally. And then you had two more, one of them being so bizarre.
I love this. Me and Rick both at the same... As soon as I started laughing, I was like, oh my god, he knew what I was talking about.
Yeah.
I just lost it. I was laughing so hard at this.
100-foot robot golf!
Dude, I want it so bad, and I don't know why. I don't normally like games
I
like
feel
this.
Like this is becoming a genre of its own, is slapstick.
Yeah. Yes!
Octodad, Pain back in the day. What was the most recent... Another recent one. It wasn't Octodad. What was the other one? There was Surgeon Simulator, I Am Bread, this.
Goat Simulator.
Yeah, Goat Simulator. Like, there's
which
a new genre.
Which also was talked about.
Yeah. I don't remember how. I think that was in the TGA, actually.
Where they add new characters, including
so
a dolphin.
I feel like slapstick is becoming its own genre in gaming. It's kind of weird.
I want it, though.
What else? And then we had Ace Combat 7, which actually is pretty cool.
It looked really good. Yeah. I'm not going to lie. And, you know, Ace Combat's a series that I go back and forth with. My brother, actually, for some reason, was really into it.
No, Gollum wasn't the game that I saw that. It was definitely at the VGAs.
Yeah, so maybe it was the...
I don't know what it would have been then. We went through the TGAs and you didn't say anything.
There was something there. I might not know the name. I have to see it.
Yeah, how about this, Mike?
You know what, though? It's not that it's too little too... I mean, it's too little too late for myself and Puss. I probably will go back in and play it. I might do it for Tuesday's stream. I'm not sure. But for the people that are in the game, I mean, this is something that we've been like, why was this not in there originally?
Yeah.
The maps are already set up for it. There's a reason why certain sparrows are faster than others. You know, there's a reason why there's rain. Like, this was already planned ahead of release, and it was...
It just took them a while to deliver.
It was one of those things that was scrapped, and they had to figure out how to introduce it again. But it's interesting.
Free, right?
It's free.
Yeah.
If you have the Taken King, you know, so myself, Dean, Rick, Puss can play. None of us are. I'm probably the only one that will do it.
I mean, it's cool. It was a nice little announcement there.
Yeah.
Then we had, this is the one here. Dean, are you sure it wasn't this? It was called Hob. Does this look like it could have been the one for you? You might need to look on the screen here if you want to see it good. Kind of reminds me of, for some reason, reminds me of Knack, but like as a third person.
No,
like,
I was actually kind of intrigued by this.
Yeah, I think this looks good. Thank you, Evil C Viper, for the follow.
I like these types of games.
Yeah, I think this looks great, personally. I like the cel-shaded look of it.
It reminds me a little bit of Bastion.
Yeah, maybe a little bit of Bastion, too. What do you think of this one, Greg? Hob?
It looks okay-ish.
It sounds like you weren't blown away by PlayStation Experience at all.
Not really at all. I was just very angry, because the first trailer I watched was the Uncharted 4 one, and then I just all went downhill from there.
I just don't know why he's so angry.
He's so angry about the Elena thing.
It's so fucking infuriating, and I just don't get why I'm the only one in that boat. I found Tobes is with me on it, but... and it makes me so angry when people are like, I hope he ends up with Chloe.
That's what makes the story great, in my opinion. To go to back to it, like, I like that he's a really flawed person. Like, this is the dilemma. And I think, I love that they're doubling down on it. Like, it's like, it actually is making me question if he's going to end up with Elena. And that's what I like about it. That should be a question. That's the point of this game.
That gets me, though. It's like, Joel was flawed in The Last of Us. But, like, his decisions and his actions were all the things that I would have done as a person. Like... everything that he did, I was like, yep, I would have done the same exact thing.
But that's what makes a game great. Like, you shouldn't have to be able to put yourself into that character and be like, that's exactly what I would have done for it to be a good story.
I get that, but, like, all the things that they set up Elena to be, it just, everything, every fucking game that they have with her, she gets screwed over so bad, and it's always, like, it's never a big, I mean, I guess it shouldn't happen.
I guess the question is, how are you still surprised by it, then?
I haven't
Because they keep setting her up to be this huge part, and then she gets shit on in every game, and that's why I'm so confused by them. Because Uncharted 1, they set her up to be the girl that makes him go on the adventure and become the great guy.
Yeah, I understand. But it's intentional. Like, this is the story they're telling.
Not even trying to troll you, Greg. I didn't even think about this once when I saw that trailer.
Nobody did.
I did, Greg. I'm with you. I did think of it, but I like it, is the difference.
I really didn't. I didn't even think of it like, oh, that's going to be a big
And it made me so happy. The first thing I noticed in every Uncharted trailer is Drake wearing the wedding band. And I don't remember if you guys remember the very first trailer that they showed up in Uncharted 4 where he's playing in the puddle and he gets up and goes into the forest and he was wearing the wedding band. That was the first thing I wrote. Like, on all comments, on forums, I was like, him and Elena are together. Like, they're
everybody else is like, oh my god, this is the greatest movie ever. This is the greatest looking game ever made. This looks so good. Drake's double, and Greg's like, Drake's married!
You're such a shipper, Greg. You're such a shipper.
Every single franchise and series, whether it be television, movies, games, like, I love when when my couples in my head get together and they become a thing. Like, nobody wants Kairi and Riku in Kingdom Hearts. Like, that
shit
just can't happen.
That's what this is about, though. This is what
they are catering to me.
This is what you wanted, and because it's not what you wanted, you're mad.
We don't know what happened.
See, here's the thing, Greg. Honestly, in the end, I think you'll get what you want. You'll probably end up with Elena, but I really like that the seed has been planted. That, like, I'm questioning it now. Like, wow, maybe he won't end up with Elena.
Pause. That's not to say if Uncharted 4 ends and he doesn't pick Elena, like, I could still like the game. My dilemma with Naughty Dog is that they set her up in all these instances where he goes back to her. And I get it. I get what you guys are saying. Like, it's a plot device. I shouldn't be shocked at all. But, like, don't make her such an essential part to the story then. Like, just have her be like Chloe in Uncharted 3. Like, she's there. She's a thing. Like, she's going to come up from time to time. But Chloe was not essential at all to that plot line. Like, Elena's essential in all three games. And that's what pisses me off is they don't utilize her like that. And she gets shit on time and time again. Pisses me off.
We could talk about this forever, but I think you're looking at it entirely the wrong way. Like, they're not like pushing her to the background and making her an afterthought. They totally thought about this. Like, that was intentional. Like, they're telling a story about him choosing between the life of a treasure hunter and life as a married man, like settling down. Like, that is
he
the story.
Chose.
This is a thief's end.
He chose when he hooked up with Chloe and Uncharted.
That's what I'm saying. Like, I this is the story they're telling. But it's not going the way.
Like
when he goes to give up on everything and he lays on her lap on the couch, like before they go to get Sully and everything to get on the plane to go do the final treasure grab and like take down everybody, and he lays down on her lap, and that scene where she just like strokes his head and she's like, "It's all right, Nate. Like you could rest. Like finally, just rest now." Like those are the moments where he should be like, "Oh my God, I should appreciate this woman. She's everything good in my life." And instead, he's like,
fuck it, let's go do some crazy shit. Sully, you're 90 years old and can still jump as well as I can.
Like, here's the problem. Skylar, she's basically the Skylar of this. From Breaking Bad. She's the one holding him down, which is fine. I'm okay if he goes with that at the end. But that's her point, is she's holding him down.
She's not a Skylar. The game starts right after he has that conversation with his brother. He takes the ring off and he's like,
throws it in the lake.
Guys, but I'm telling you right now that that's not the purpose of the game. Like, she's not Skylar at all. In Uncharted 2, the way they meet is because she's still going out and being crazy and adventurous. She's reporting on that same exact thing that he's going to treasure hunt for. Like, Elena's still dangerous and daring. The only reason why she gets mad at Drake is because he continues to lie to her. That's his flaw. It's not that Elena's holding him back from anything. Elena and all three.
We're not talking about Sunny Martina. We have to move on.
Guys, we're getting Ni No Kuni 2!
Yeah, I've rewound this trailer three times now. We're getting Ni No Kuni 2. Greg, we will get to that in a PlayStation, like,
no
episode or something like that.
No!
I feel like we're just that. We just talked
about it. We could, we'll talk about it more, I'm sure, in the future. But we do have to talk about Ni No Kuni 2, because this was the second best announcement of the entire
show.
Easily, yeah. But, Greg, have you played Ni No Kuni?
Yeah, I love. This was the only other announcement that I got excited
yeah,
about.
Yeah, right? This was the saving grace of the show for me, because after the beginning, it was like, come on, come on, come on. And then Ni No Kuni 2 came. I was like, all right, I'm happy. We got Final Fantasy VII footage. We got Ni No Kuni. It looks like this time we're not having a character that goes to the world. This is a character from the world.
Which is exciting.
What was that, Greg?
I said that's exciting to me.
Yeah, I think it's cool. It's a story within the world of Ding Dong Dell and all that kind of stuff. It's done by a studio, Ghibli, if you guys don't know. They're very well known for Princess Mononoke, Spirited Away, Kiki's Delivery Service, a lot of great Japanese animation films.
I missed out on the first one, we all know.
And you should fix that.
Do you, like, it still holds up?
Yes, 100%.
Okay. Is this going to be very Final Fantasy-esque, where it's unrelated?
It's turn-based. It's more like Pokemon, actually, I would say. Okay. Would you agree with that, Greg?
Yeah, it's very much more Pokemon. You kind of capture all these little creatures and these monsters with all the same JRPG elements, I should say. It's definitely still Japanese RPG. And they give it to you more in the world. It's like Pokemon mixed with Kingdom Hearts for me, and that's why I fell in love with it.
Right, I mean, the only reason I haven't played is I don't have a PS3.
Yeah.
You know, so that's good. The only reason I haven't gotten to it.
Well, maybe they'll remaster the original. That'd be great.
I would love that.
It'd be so beautiful.
I have it free for PS Plus, though, on the PS3.
Wait, oh, you do? Gene, yeah, word, might neither of you played it?
I never even heard of it. This is the first time I ever
played
it. It's really good.
Oh, that
really, really
so
good.
Fun.
But
I've
it
seen
is
you play it.
Japanese RPG.
Yeah, it's long. It's very in-depth. Like,
yeah.
Combined, like, these games come out of the woodwork, but like, I don't ever hear anybody fucking talk about them. How good could they possibly be?
Ni No Kuni was huge last generation.
Yeah.
That was
the
one Japanese RPG that everyone's like, this is a Japanese RPG.
I'm not trying to shit on it. I'm just saying I never
got great reviews. Yeah. It sold so much better than anybody was expecting.
If there is somebody that's into JRPGs and, you know, stuff like that, they know about this game.
Yeah. It's great. And I'm so excited that they announced that. And now finally, let's get to the closer, the mic drop here. I'm happy that they used M83's outro. They watched my video, and they were like, I gotta do this.
Alright, I mean, here's my thing, is I feel like there's other games that could have used it, and now they can't really use that song for a little
what
while.
What if they did? What if they did?
Right?
Because a lot of people saw that video,
yeah.
And people from fucking PlayStation saw that video.
Yeah. To be 100% honest with you, I'm so surprised that M83 isn't used in every single video game trailer ever, because that is perfect trailer music.
Yeah, all their stuff.
There's like three other M83 songs that I can't wait to make a video for, and I've got it in my mind. I've got the cogs turning, like Tears Becoming a Sea. Like, I'm ready to go on that song, and it'll come eventually. Greg is muted again. Greg, you're muted. He's like, yeah, I'm muted. Greg, hold on one sec. I'll get you back. But yeah, this was the mic drop moment. I think it is big. I think you guys are kind of underestimating that it does have some clout to it.
Here's the thing. There's a difference between,
it's just gone.
I immediately was like, I don't care about this. To me, this sucks. Yeah. I mean, it's not terrible, but I don't care about this part at all. I wish I didn't end on this.
Greg, you there?
Yep.
Okay, cool. Just making sure.
Yep.
But then I was watching character reactions, not character, or like the audience reactions. You could hear the audience. They opened up the mics for a second, because they were expecting a roar and they wanted the applause right before the thing. And you didn't hear anything. You heard grumblings. You heard low things. You heard a couple.
The reason you heard grumblings is because then the montage started and everyone's like, oh, that's the closer. It's not that it was a bad reveal. It's just that it shouldn't have been the closer.
Well, yes, but I'm saying the lack of comment and cheering and anything like that was already going on. You need to rewatch the Compton thing. I watched it twice because I watched it when I first came home, and I watched it again to get everything else, and I watched that part twice, and there's nobody reacting in the way that they wanted.
I think the problem was that everybody came into PlayStation Experience, and rightfully so, expecting Sony Bend. Like, where the hell was that? Hashtag Colin was wrong. Sony Bend, where's Shu? Where the hell is Shu? Right. Where is God of War? Like, there's so many things we still don't know about. How do we not know what these studios are freaking working on? Like, there's so many, there's like five freaking studios working on big games that we know nothing about that can't be that far away. Sony Bend has worked on nothing since freaking Vita with Uncharted, with Golden Abyss.
They haven't worked on something since that. They have huge games that, like, even though, like, they've already been revealed, like, you should have, like, nobody even brought them up, dude. Like, Horizon and The Last Guardian.
Yep.
We're not at the fucking PlayStation.
Last Guardian. I completely forgot about that. Where the hell is The Last Guardian?
Like,
where's...
What?
Where's Rhyme?
I know. It was not... That's what I'm saying. Like,
I forgot all about
this
that,
was
yeah.
not... This was not the PSX. Like, I know we should be grateful, but, like, I'm not going to be grateful. Because, like, last year, they were like, this is it. This is for PlayStation gamers. And, like, PlayStation gamers aren't playing your fucking MOBA. Like, we're playing Uncharted, dude. We're playing God of War. Like, nobody wants that shit. Like, this was not... It wasn't
boo,
good.
You! Boo, go home!
It just wasn't good.
The thing is, you know, you kind of reinforce it yourself. You said you got to be grateful for it, but you're sitting here, we didn't get Last Guardian, we didn't get...
Dude,
no.
I said it already. The moment they showed Final Fantasy VII, I was like, all right, I'm good. They could have ended there, and I was totally happy.
Right.
Ni No Kuni, dude, I'm so excited. Like this,
I'm
we got two
that.
Great things at this conference, and that's all I needed. That being said, I'm surprised. I'm just very surprised they didn't take advantage of this December conference,
right.
knowing that they didn't have really anything at the Game Awards, yeah. and they won't have anything now until at least Gamescom. Like, where the hell are these things?
That's kind of like the thing, right? They said that they weren't going to be showing a lot at the other couple the last couple conferences. Because they had so many conferences to do this year, but really, they didn't really show what people were expecting at any of them.
Yeah.
You know, and don't get me wrong, Ni No Kuni, fucking huge, huge, huge welcome. I am 100% on board with that, and there's a lot of people that are. You know, stuff like that is okay to me.
Yeah.
But when two of your big parts of your conference are things that were already shown before in a different way, that doesn't mean very good things for you. You know, we're also underestimating Ace Combat. That has a huge following.
Yeah, it does.
A huge core fan base. The whole thing about unveiling a character was kind of funny. He actually did bring it up in the right way. There's a lot of people that are huge with fighting games and Street Fighter, and he said, this is entertaining to me because it's the first character that we've been able to announce that hasn't been spoiled, you know, by a leak online, you know, which is 100% correct and, mm-hmm. you know, accurate, which I thought was great, but... Overall, it just...
I think in general, what happened here is Sony misgauged, if that's even a word, mm-hmm. misgauged expectations.
Yeah.
Like, they didn't understand it. Like, expectations for this were freaking high.
Yeah.
Like, we were expecting Sony Bend. We were expecting God of War. We were expecting Crash Bandicoot, maybe. Even.
Something,
like,
dude.
Just something. Like, a megaton moment. Final Fantasy VII, for a lot of people, was maybe that moment. Ni No Kuni, for me, was close to that moment. But the mass audience, they wanted, like, a God of War.
I feel like at this point, what they need to do with these conferences is E3 should definitely be the announcement of games. 100%. You know, you want to announce that you're making a new God of War, bam, you flash a small teaser,
I mean,
snippet.
It's possible,
right? And then
that they're just waiting for E3 because of that. Like, maybe they got all these games, dude, and they're just going to fucking, like,
I get that.
My theory actually is that there was more planned for this.
Right.
And then they saw, we're freaking killing Black Friday, we're killing the holiday season.
Yeah.
We don't need to do this right now.
Yeah.
Let's wait for E3 next year to make sure that, like, things aren't going bad and suddenly our sales are dwindling and then we'll reveal The Last of Us 2 or some shit and blow minds. Like, maybe they just realize, like, we don't need to do this yet.
Well, I'm saying, but that actually fits into what I'm saying. So you do your big reveals, your big things that normally would be mic drop moments, so like your Final Fantasy 7 reveal, you know, your brand new games, a partnership, you know, with Bethesda for Elder Scrolls, what?
People still going with the Surge and Durverse thing.
Dude, that's awesome. That's my favorite thing that happens. I'm laughing. Dude, alright. But then you use E3 for those things that get people spiked, that get, you know, investors hyped and everything, and use PSX to show gameplay.
Yeah.
Use it like they did for Final Fantasy VII. Mike drop at Final Fantasy VII with a teaser at E3, and bam, show gameplay and show everything we want.
That's
use
what I mean.
It that
like,
way. That's what
we need. I wasn't asking for a mic drop. I was asking for...
reinforcement
games, dude.
Right.
Like
Sony PlayStation
like
games.
This was okay, like I understand I'm not the target audience for the JRPGs, and there is a core audience out there for them.
That's what's funny is the two huge moments were Final Fantasy VII
and
Nino Kuni,
right.
Two
and
games that don't
like,
I don't give a fuck.
That's fine, dude. I get people like them, but like here's the deal, this conference took place in California. You're on the fucking, you're not in Japan. Like these are not games everyone's gonna care about. The people who are, like, dragging these consoles home for the holidays aren't going home to play fucking Ni No Kuni. You know what I mean? Like, it's just not. That's not.
I mean,
to have the woman come out and talk about Battlefront for 5 minutes.
Dude,
like,
oh my god.
Or Call of Duty. It's like, come, just
like
get
that.
And, what, and that's the other problem is that they think that that's the other core audience. They're missing their
missing
full
it.
Demographic. That was way too long.
My worry is that, like E3, it's becoming a... advertisement now.
Yes.
For like, you know, Activision's like, you partnered with us, show our game.
Right.
Like this is your stadium to show our game. Do it. Battlefront. Mm-hmm. We're your bundle for the holiday. Better show our freaking game. Now they waste 10 minutes on that that we don't really care about, but they're forced to do it because they've got these contractual obligations.
Brutal, dude. And I like Call of Duty, and I'm still brutal.
Yeah, it's like that's the kind of stuff that we don't want to see, but maybe they have to do it. Like maybe that's what's paying.
She was also just
these
a really
things.
Bad presenter. She was stumbling on
how many
everything.
Times is she just like
that was her what's my word again that I say all the time, basically.
Yeah.
That was her basically.
Yeah.
Like I need a transition word here, guys. Woo!
That's, so
that's what they went with. Alright, we went so long today. Alright, that's it. That was our PSX reaction. That was our the Game Awards reactions. If you guys liked this show at any point, I thought this was an awesome show. I had a lot of fun tonight.
Yeah, me too.
Thanks for watching. Don't forget to follow us at twitch.tv/TheLevelUpShow. We had follows from Evil C Viper. We also had the Arbiter 5. A lot of network follows that I'm not going to name just because we need you guys to follow on twitch.tv/TheLevelUpShow. Big Benny, thank you for the follow. We also had Tommy B the Ginger and Claire. Those are our follows tonight on the Level Up Show, our main channel.
Didn't Dead Mouse say like at the VGAs where everybody was forced to talk about Battlefront and how great Battlefront was? Didn't Dead Mouse basically like I don't like it?
I didn't hear
that
personally.
I have to go back and watch that because I heard that he basically was just like I don't care.
Don't forget, you can follow us on all our other channels as well. Thank you to Ruriku, 333 for the follow. Really appreciate it. Keep those follows coming, guys. So follow us on Twitter at the Level Up Network, levels but LVL. As I said, we really need PlayStation questions. Thank you again to Saycons for the question. PlayStation questions at Twitter with hashtag IODP. It only does PlayStation. That will be Wednesday of next week, our PlayStation exclusive show. So look forward to that. You go on youtube.com/TheLevelUpShow, levels but LVL. Subscribe while you're there. Check out all of our archived footage and look forward to Power Up. That is Dean and Greg's superhero comic book nerdiness show on every week. There you go. We have the levelupnetwork.com/donate. If you want to best support this network, donate there. Just a singular donation if you want. Or go to levelupshow.spreadshirt.com to buy Level Up themed hoodies, muscle shirts, t-shirts, and more. And finally, the best way to support the network is Patreon at patreon.com/thelevelupnetwork. Just donate $1 per month or more, of course, and you can get some perks like early access to Power Up on our YouTube channel. If you pronounce it Surge or Durverse, you're gonna have a bad time. I think that it should have been called that, to be honest with you. Surge or Durverse. Alright, and that is gonna wrap it up for us. Greg, any final words, man?
Melina should get some sort of. I just hope, even if Drake. This is how I'm gonna end it. Really short and really simple. Nobody respond. Nobody respond. Ready?
Go ahead.
Drake doesn't pick Elena. At least give her somewhat of a decent epilogue ending. That's all I ask.
Okay. All right. No response.
He asks us not to.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, is so unfair. You can't just tell people not to fucking respond to your shit.
Let's do our special thanks real quick before doing the outro video here. We had a lot of subs and patrons and all that, so special thanks to our subs, who are The Nine Fox, Tyspin, Johnny Poolside, Delone Gunman, Miss Amanda, Mr. Rager 909, Baz023S, Level Up Host Drew, Moofy, Tobes, Chalkar. We also have our patrons. They are Pussfilled Scab or Johnny Poolside, Tim's Moriendi, Mr. Rager 909, The Nine Fox, Tyspin, BMC Music, TX Puck, DragonCon, Blakey 1888, Mark Conklin, Alex Bustos, Lionhammer, Toves, and Thomas Hillman. And finally, our moderators, Pussfilled Scab or Johnny Poolside, The Nine Fox, TX Puck, GFN2112, Ghost Games, and Guitar Freak 12345, our resident PC mod. Thank you guys. Really appreciate all your supports. Final words, you guys. What's going on?
I got nothing, man.
Yeah, let's wrap this show up.
Damn thing.
Choo-choo, motherfucker.
Choo-choo, motherfuckers! Alright, thanks for watching, guys. Until next time, take care. And as always, don't forget to never burp. Nice. Beautiful. Gotta turn up the volume.
Everyone said in the chat. They all said Greg was so happy and joyous and singing, and then we just had to bring up a joke.
Don't forget, Greg will be on tomorrow. What are you playing, Greg?
I'm not sure. I have a bunch of stuff that I can play. I'm not sure what I'm doing.
And I might do Life is Strange earlier in the day, before Greg.
You off tomorrow?
No, but Kristen has something to go to at night. Greg, I apologize once again.
I'm muted?
No! You weren't in the outro, even though I made it. I forgot to put it into the lineup.
Oh, I don't care about that.
You should. You should care.
Sorry.
All right, guys. Thanks for watching. We'll be on all week long with gaming talk shows and game streams. Level up.
Level up. I love you all equally, maybe Elena the most.